We present Kenneth Williams, Derek Nimmo, Clement Freud, and Liz Fraser in just a minute. And as the minute waltz fades away, here to tell you about it is our chairman, Nicholas Parsons.
Thank you. Thank you very much indeed, and welcome once again to Just a Minute. And somebody's whistling. Derek Nimmo, it's you. Will you please keep quiet?
Sorry.
Derek, why are you whistling before we've even started?
Just a little seasonal whistling, that's all.
All right, we're all trying to get into the festive spirit. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the show, and also it's my pleasure to welcome Liz Fraser. For the first time, she's going to try and do battle with these three clever protagonists of the game and see what she can do for the Distaff side. Once again, I'm going to ask them all to speak, if they can, for 60 seconds on some subject, without hesitation, without repetition, and without deviating from the subject. And of course, according to how well they do it and whether they're challenged, they will gain points or give them away. Clement Freud, will you begin this week, please? The subject, very seasonal, stuffing your Christmas bird. That means, can you talk about that subject for 60 seconds, starting now?
Any feathered friend which is afloat at this time of year may be called a Christmas bird. And if you're about to stuff one, I think you should take great care not to choose a bird that is too small, like a sparrow or a dove. In fact, a turkey, a chicken, a goose would be ideal animals for this sort of treatment. I feel that it is ignominious to put your hands inside such poultry, and prefer personally to get my stuffing done on the outside, usually in a roasting tray, keeping such implements as I might use in my culinary pursuits cleaner and less infected than they would otherwise be. But there are many.
Daring Nimmo, you challenge. Why?
No hesitation.
No. I'm keeping it with Clement Freud. So he gains a point because I disagree with the challenge. 6 seconds left. Stuffing your Christmas bird, Clement, now.
Some people think that bird being a synonym...
For those of you who may be fairly new to the game, when the whistle goes, it tells us that 60 seconds is up, and whoever is speaking at that moment gains an extra point. On this occasion, it was Clement Freud, who now has a commanding lead of 2 over everybody else, because nobody else has yet scored. And, Derek, it's your turn to begin. The subject is stocking fillers. Can you talk to us? That's a dirty laugh in the audience, wasn't it? Anyway, Derek, stocking fillers, 60 seconds, starting now.
Responding to the dirty laugh in the audience, I would say that my favourite stocking filler is long limbs encased in a pair of these same stockings that we are talking about. On the other hand, there is a dear little man who lives in Snowman.
Clement Freud, why have you challenged?
He's talking about legs and suddenly says, on the other hand, with nothing.
Give Clement Freud an extra point for a clever challenge, but Derek wasn't deviating from the subject on the card. Stocking fillers, Derek, you keep the subject and continue, and there are 42 seconds left, starting now.
In Snowland lives a charming old gentleman with a white beard, as every boy and girl knows.
I didn't know that.
Liz Fraser, you challenged.
Yes, I didn't know that.
She's not a boy.
Well, I'm
You're
sorry that you don't know it, Liz, and maybe after the show I can explain to you all about Father Christmas. You see, he wasn't actually deviating from the subject, he was keeping going. The fact that you didn't know about it, unlike everybody else, it's very sad.
It is.
But it means that Derek still keeps the subject, and he gets a point, of course. And there are 35 seconds left, stocking fillers, starting now.
Santa Claus, or Father Christmas, as Nicholas Parsons would say, keeps his stocking fillers in a large sack, which he keeps on the back of his sleigh.
Kenneth Williams has challenged.
The word keep occurred twice.
Yes, that is right. You did say keep twice. It was a bit, yes, you did. It's rather difficult.
Keep.
Small words, not to repeat them occasionally. Kenneth, I agree with your challenge, so you've gained a point, and you have 27 seconds for stocking fillers, starting now.
Little cuddly bunnies made of cotton wool and harmless material like that, and marzipans, chocolates, and little wafers. You delight
this. Malady challenged.
He said little twice.
Yes, I'm afraid you did. And she was listening terribly well, got him very sharply there. And, because you see, if you press your buzzer first, it eliminates all the other buzzers.
Quite so right. Quite, I don't want to safe. Eliminate anybody else's buzzer.
No, well... So, Liz, you've gained a point, and you have 15 seconds now to take over the subject of stocking fillers, starting now.
One of the advantages of growing older and bigger is that one's stockings enlarge with age, which means that one can get more fillings into one's... hosiery.
Hesitation.
There was a definite hesitation, I'm afraid, Liz. Derek, you gain a point. I agree with the challenge. So there are 3 seconds left now for you to take over stocking fillers, starting...
When I wake up on Christmas morning, I find a lovely orange right at the bottom next to a...
Kenneth Williams, why do you chuckle?
Christmas, you said it before.
You did say Christmas before, you used Father Christmas before, and now you've said Christmas.
So absolutely Kenneth... right. Well, listen.
Occasionally they can't think of any other way to argue their way back to it, so they come magnanimous. Kenneth listened well, he got in just with 3/4 of a second to go on stocking fillers. Kenneth, starting now.
Silver bells! Silver bells!
Kenneth Williams was speaking then when the whistle went, so he gains that extra point, and to use his phrase, he has leapt into the lead.
Well, thank goodness, my record has been abysmal over the last few weeks. Abysmal!
But you've leapt...
The only way I can describe it. It's been abysmal. I've seen no kind of encouragement, and we all need a bit of ego massage.
You're behaving in an abysmal way.
Oh,
yes, because you've leapt into the lead alongside Clement Freud. It's not quite enough
I
to...
see.
And Liz Fraser, it's your turn to begin. So, the subject is, still on the Christmas theme, I'm glad to say, things I've found in crackers. And as a little cracker yourself, Liz, will you talk for 60 seconds on that subject, starting now?
One of the things that I found in crackers was my husband. It happened like this. I had an invitation some years ago to attend a housewarming party by a friend, and I agreed and accepted with alacrity, and bejeweled and bedecked, I arrived at her abode, and I had the feeling that something very exciting was going to happen. And I looked around the rooms to see if there was some sort of nice man that I could perhaps be attached to. A tall, dark stranger approached me and asked me where the loo was. I didn't know, so I directed him to the hostess who was standing near me at the time, and another man approached me, and we found that we had a great deal in common. For instance, we both enjoyed Dick Nimmo's feet, Clement Freud's cooking, Kenneth Williams' wit, and Nicholas Parson's milk. And he then proposed to me.
I must say
that the house's name was Crackers.
Liz Fraser has joined us for the first time. She started with a subject and she managed to keep it right through to the end, so she gets a bonus point for speaking for 60 seconds. Well done, Liz. Clement, your turn to begin. The subject is the fairy on the top of the Christmas tree. And that laugh, listeners, was occasioned by the fact that Clement Freud looked very rapidly at every member of the team here to decide which one he thought he should apply this to. And he finished up with Liz Fraser. So the subject is the fairy on the top of the Christmas tree, Clement Freud, 60 seconds, starting now.
Is a very long way up the top of the Christmas tree, as opposed to the fairy lower down on the same piece of...
Liz Fraser, you challenge.
I think hesitation.
You think, and I think, and so you gain a point, Liz, and you take over the subject of the fairy on the top of the Christmas tree. 50 seconds left, starting now.
There are no fairies at the top of our Christmas tree because... I knew I was going to talk.
Kenneth Williams, your challenge.
Great hesitation.
Yes, I didn't know what I was going to say.
My darling, I don't like to be ungallant, but I'm sure.
You weren't, you were being absolutely accurate.
Oh,
so,
you
Kenneth,
much.
You get a point. You take over the subject. There are 45 seconds left. The fairy on the top of the Christmas tree, starting now.
She is generally a rather delicate-looking creature with tinsel and porcelain, mice-like features, and everyone says there she is presiding over this festive gathering and spreading light and joy. joy from the top of her perishing Christmas tree. And it is very pretty, indeed, of course, it is in the process of decay, as you all know, when you come to clear up those dreadful needles that get everywhere. I once sat on them and had them with appalling trouble afterwards, but only a very greasy emollient eased my anguish.
Challenge. Why?
Well, he's talking about something really rather nasty, which has got nothing to do with a fairy. It was way up on the top of the tree.
Yes, and there are 8 seconds left, Derek, for the fairy on the top of the Christmas tree, starting now.
When I was a small boy, I used to sing a lovely song, which was, every little boy would like to be a fairy.
Clement Freud, why have you challenged?
Repetition.
What?
When I was a small boy.
Oh, that's right, yes. Clement, you gained the subject, and there are 3 seconds left. Fairy on the top of the Christmas tree, starting now.
Her name is Gladys, and she had the most terrible time getting up.
Clement Freud then gained the extra point for speaking when the whistle went. I've never heard of a fairy called Gladys. What a...
It's a pity. It's a nice
anyway, fancy, Gladys got you an extra point, an extra laugh, and you're now equal in the lead with Kenneth Williams.
Oh, what an honour for you, Clement.
Oh. Derek Nimmo, your turn to begin. The subject, mistletoe. Can you talk to us about that kissable subject for 60 seconds, starting now?
Mistletoe is a rather nasty parasitic creature that grows round fruit trees, apples and pears in particular. It's been used from the ancient times to depict something which is really rather nasty, so we won't talk about that. We'll talk about its modern usage, which is to kiss young ladies beneath. And there's nothing I like more, in fact, than singing, "Here we are, beneath the mistletoe, no young..."
Liz Fraser, why have you challenged?
Beneath twice.
Two beneaths give you an extra point, another point, I mean, and you take over the subject of mistletoe, and there are 36 seconds left, starting now.
I always thought that it would be the most romantic thing to be kissed underneath the mistletoe, and every year I would stand strategically placed under this... under twice.
Derek Nimmo, why have you challenged? Derek, I agree with the challenge of hesitation. You get another point, and there are 12 seconds left, mistletoe, starting now.
Once I spent Yuletide south of the equator, and there they had plastic mistletoe. I'm nothing more obscene have I ever seen. And if you...
Liz Fraser, why have you challenged?
Is seen a verb twice?
No, you said obscene. I've seen.
Oh, I do beg your pardon.
It was well listened. But not correct. So Derek gets another point, and there are 3 seconds left for mistletoe, Derek, starting now.
Pucker up your lips, babe. I'm coming in on the down.
Kenneth, party games. Can you tell us something about party games? And there are 60 seconds to do it, starting now.
I think it was probably expressed most beautifully by Bernard Gascoigne when he wrote, "Here's a pencil and pad, you won't find it bad. These are games that we all of us know. Pass them on as you write them and ad infinitum. It's just party games. Make a good evening go." And even as he uttered those words to me for the first time, a tear began to form in my eye and drop to the floor below, where it ate its way through to the floorboards.
Derek Nimmo, why have you challenged?
Floor and then floorboards. Two floors.
Yes, alas, it was a pity.
Oh, he's very fly, isn't he?
Yes, it was a lovely story.
But
so, Derek,
what a beautiful poem.
Yes, and what a beautiful teardrop right through to the floorboard. Anyway, Derek, I agree with the challenge. There are 19 seconds left for party games, starting now.
My favourite party game is called Stuffing Your Christmas Bird. What you have to do is to get a large turkey and some sage and onion stuffing, and everybody gathers...
Liz Fraser, why have you challenged?
Stuffing twice.
Stuffing your Christmas bird, right, stuffing. Right. That's quite correct, Liz. Well, listen, 14 seconds left for you, Liz. You take over the subject of party games, starting now.
Are you...
Oh, Clement Freud, why have you challenged?
Hesitation,
not at all.
That was breath.
First time on the show, and there you... Anyway, Liz, you have another point, and there are 13 seconds left for party games, starting now.
I first met...
Clement Freud, why have you challenged?
Hesitation.
No. Even less hesitation. There are 13 seconds left for party games, Liz, starting now.
I first met Clement Freud at a party, and he asked if I would participate in...
Clement Freud, you've challenged.
Hesitation.
I agree.
Of course, you don't let her get out what she was going to say you said. That's why.
I must say, she stuttered over the thought of what she was going to
yes,
say.
Yes,
oh dear, what a pity. We may never know. Perhaps it's as well. Perhaps the series will continue. There are 7 seconds left with you, Clement Freud, to continue with party games starting now.
My favourite party game is getting Ebenezer Scrooge into a stocking filler.
Kenneth and his wife, why have you challenged?
It's deviation. Getting Ebenezer Scrooge into a stocking...
It's impossible at this particular time, yes, because he does not exist. I give you a point and the subject, and there are 2.5 seconds left. Party games starting now.
We're supposed to take hold of your partner's hand and in her ear...
Well, at the end of that round, Kenneth was speaking once again, so he got the extra point. Liz Fraser crept up in the middle of that game and has now overtaken them, has 1 point lead over the other three at the end of that round. So it really is neck and neck. Liz, your turn to begin. The subject is carol singing. Would you talk about that for 60 seconds, starting now?
Good King Wenceslas stepped out.
Kenneth, why have you...
I've challenged because deviation, you should ask to talk about it and should proceed to sing about it.
Yeah, that's a...
And
you
it's carol
ask
singing.
To talk about it.
Yes, it's a very good challenge, because I did say actually talk about it, and she started to demonstrate it.
Well, she's new.
What's that?
She's new.
She's new. So let me put it to the audience. Now, do you think, I say, will you talk about it? She was demonstrating it. If you agree with Kenneth's challenge, would you cheer? And if you disagree, will you boo? And will you all do it together now? If you disagree with Kenneth, you're on the lady's side. She's new to the game, which seems very justified. So
you brainwashed all of them.
Liz gains a point and keeps the subject. There are 55 seconds left for carol singing, starting now.
When the snow lay round about, deep and crisp and even brightly.
Kenneth, why are you chant?
Well, all this Anne. Anne, Chris, Anne, all this Anne.
Well, technically, she was repeating herself, wasn't she? So I suppose, to be fair, what?
Give
it to Kenneth. I did say and.
No, I'm not going to charge any points. That's the fairest thing to do. I'm going to leave the subject with Liz Fraser. No points charged, because I'm not going to charge on ands. I think we've once before established that. 47 seconds left. Carol singing, Liz, starting now.
It is not generally known that I have the most exquisite voice with the range of...
Clement Freud challenged that time.
Hesitation.
Hesitation. I agree, Clement, you gain a point and the subject, and there are 42 seconds left. Carol singing starting now.
When the mince pie is wheeled in on the trolley, we hold hands and sing carols, especially Carol. She...
Liz Fraser challenged. Why?
Well, I thought he said Carol twice, but the first one was actually
this
Carol's.
This is what happens. He tries to be clever,
yes,
and the first person in often gets stumped. So I disagree, because it was Carol's, and now it's a girl called Carol. Clement gets another point, and there are 33 seconds left for carol singing, Clement, starting now.
The holly and the ivy and good and king and Wenceslas and many other lovely carols and...
Liz Fraser, why have you challenged?
Carols.
Yes, well done. It wasn't for and.
Well done.
And there are 22 seconds left for carol singing, Liz, starting now.
And because I have this marvellous voice, I am asked every Christmas time to go singing with the choirs which are going around the various districts in our area. And I go armed with a flask of gargle water and sing Once in Royal David's City, Silent Night, Good King Wenceslas...
Derek Nimmo challenged.
Repetition of Good King Wenceslas.
Yes, because you sang that before.
Yes, I did sing that before.
So Derek got in very clever just before the whistle. There's half a second to go. Carol singing.
I have a lovely nubile
The audience here all went, but you see, it must be fair in the game, because Ian Messler hadn't actually blown the whistle, so Derek was in. And it's even more exciting, because we have three leaders all together, and Kenneth is behind the other three at the end of the game.
Well, as Herodotus said, what is good without my saying so. Yeah.
But you still have a chance to redress the balance, Kenneth. And the subject now is for Clement Freud. It's your turn to begin, Clement. And the subject is punch. And would you talk to us for 60 seconds, punch, starting now?
If you take equal quantities of cinnamon, clove, and nutmeg, and grate all these and dissolve it in a pint of water, adding a pound of sugar, you get the most excellent basis for a punch, especially if you allow this liquid to boil for an hour or more and then strain it through a cloth into another vessel, adding to this wine whenever you feel like it, because the important thing about punch is the wine therein must not boil.
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Revolution of wine.
Yes, we've had wine twice. Sure. So Derek gains a point and the subject.
I wanted to hear
and
the recipe.
There are 30 seconds left for punch, Derek, starting now.
In the middle of the Victorian era, a very different change came to comedy writing.
Clement Freud's challenge, why?
Hesitation.
I didn't notice a hesitation.
Oh, didn't you?
Hesitation? No,
must
no,
be the
no,
only
no,
one.
No, I don't know. There are 26 seconds for punch, Derek, starting now.
And a magazine came to be born which was called Punch and had on the front of it the gentleman who performed with Judy.
Kenneth Williams got hesitation. Him first then. Hesitation, I agree then. So, Kenneth, you get a point. And there are 19 seconds left for punch, starting now.
I received one on my nose in a barrack room in Ceylon and I remonstrated. I said, here, who do you think you're knocking about? What right have you? He said, look at that, and showed me his arm on which was three stripes, and I had none. And
Derek, would you begin the next round? And the subject is port. And there are 60 seconds for you to talk about it, starting now.
Well, one of the things I've never really gone along with is any port in a storm. It does seem to be rather a foolish thing to say. Because if one is in a tempest or a hurricane or a whirlwind and at sea, one would rather have...
Liz Fraser, why have you challenged?
No, not one.
No points scored. Leave the subject with Derek Nimmo. And there are 49 seconds left for port, Derek, starting now.
In my... fist, I'd write to
Clement through. Freud challenge, why?
Hesitation.
Yes, hesitation. This is a sad thing that sometimes it's difficult to start again. Clement, I have to agree with a definite hesitation, you gain a point, and there are 47 seconds left for port, starting now.
Port is the name given to a fortified wine made in the Oporto Valley of Portugal, where it is drunk by the English gentry, who have for years and generations, centuries in fact, been the only people to involve
Liz Fraser, why have you challenged?
Hesitation?
No, he did keep going. He was running down a little, but he kept going. So, Clement, as I disagree with the challenge, you gain another point, and there are 30 seconds left for port, starting now.
It is traditional at smart dinner parties for the ladies to leave the gentlemen and the males of the species thereafter to consume port while their female counterparts are outside.
Kenneth Williams, why have you challenged?
Because you don't, it's deviation, you don't consume port, you drink it. You consume, that is the act of eating, you see. You don't eat a drink. No, I'm not having it.
You're not having it, you tried very hard, but I mean, if you've drunk something or eaten it, it has been consumed, surely.
Oh.
So... I'm afraid, to be fair to the game, I have to disagree with the challenge, leave it with Clement Freud, and say there are 18 seconds left for port, Clement, starting now.
On board ship, port is the left-hand side, whereas starboard is the right. And many a sailor has gone to the wrong place simply because of a failure to acquaint himself with this simple form of direction. While drinking liquid...
pray that we have no more time, so that is the end of this week's contest, if you can call it that, because we like to call it a game. And I must point out right away that Derek's last challenge wouldn't have made any difference to the final result. It's a very fair one, a very interesting one, because equal in second place we had our guest for this week, first time, very good, Liz Fraser. But by a couple of points only, we have the winner once again this week, Clement Freud. We do hope that you enjoyed this particular edition of Just a Minute. All of us here would like to wish you, listening, a very, very happy Christmas. From all of us here, goodbye.
The chairman of Just a Minute was Nicholas Parsons. The programme was devised by Ian Messiter and produced by Simon Brett.
Present Kenneth Williams, Clement Freud, Peter Jones and Aimi MacDonald in Just a Minute. And as the minute waltz fades away, here to tell you about it is our chairman, Nicholas Parsons.
Thank you. Thank you very much indeed. Hello and welcome to Just a Minute. And we do hope that you all had a lovely Christmas and you're going to have a wonderful new year. And we've got four wonderful players of Just a Minute here who, full of turkey, I can see it. It's coming out of Kenneth Williams' ear holes, it's dribbling down Clement Freud's chin, and it's sprouting out of Peter Jones's, and Aimi MacDonald is looking as slim as ever. I'm going to ask them all to speak, if they can, for just a minute on some unlikely subject, or it might even be a topical one, without hesitation, without repetition, and without deviating from the subject on the card. And we're going to begin this show with Peter Jones. Peter, Silent Night. Can you talk on that for 60 seconds, starting now?
Well, it wasn't very, because there was so much noise. Children running upstairs and people trampling round in the bedrooms and in the...
Aimi MacDonald has challenged. Why?
Deviation, because he's talking about a noisy night.
A very good challenge. The audience applause convinces me that you have a correct challenge, so you gain a point for that. You take over the subject of Silent Night, and there are 50 seconds to go, starting now.
When all is quiet and you look out and the sky is sparkling with stars and you hear in the distance a choir of angels singing Silent Night, Holy Night, all is calm.
Clement Freud is challenged.
All is...
Repetition of night.
There are 37 seconds with you, Clement Freud, having gained a point, and the subject starting now.
One of the most boring conversations I ever had in my life.
Peter Jones has challenged.
I don't want to hear the most boring conversation you've ever had in your life.
Unfortunately, if you're in just a minute and wish to talk about the most boring conversation you've ever had in your life, we are forced to listen to it, because as long as he doesn't deviate from the subject on the card, he gets a point for a wrong challenge and keeps going with 33 seconds left, starting now.
Was with a deaf and dumb Scottish baronet called Sir Hamish McConachie. Good morning, I said, and there was no reply whatsoever, which surprised me at the time because I was unaware of his physical debility. But over the years, we became tremendous friends, and I must say he was the most silent night that has ever been my misfortune.
Aimi MacDonald has challenged you. Aimi, what is your challenge?
Deviation. She's not talking about that sort of night.
You believe that it wasn't such a night. You don't believe that he ever had this boring conversation.
No,
not even in his imagination. I don't believe that this night exists. If he does, perhaps he would write in, and I will award the points to Clement Freud.
How can
next
he
week.
Write in? He can't hear us.
That's why I knew I was safe, Clement, in giving Aimi MacDonald a point and the subject with only 10.5 seconds to go, Aimi. Silent Night, starting now.
One day I came home from work, and you know how it is, I was really raring to go. And I got on the telephone, and I rang up all my friends, and I said, come round and let's...
Those who follow the game will know that after 60 seconds, a whistle is blown by Ear Messiter, which tells us that we have no more time for that round, and whoever is speaking at that moment gains the extra point. It was Aimi MacDonald, so we will never know what happens when she's raring to go. But she does have a lead over everyone else at the end of that round. And, Kenneth Williams, we're now going to hear from you.
About time.
The subject is a very personal and topical one. St. Nicholas. St. Nicholas, 60 seconds with you, Kenneth, starting now.
Well, as Clement Freud will enlighteningly tell you, he was a German, and the hair shirt which he habitually wore was found in the end to have become parasitical to the flesh. That is to say, it was actually growing on him. Ooh, they cried. What an offensive odour. Get it off, Nick. Because they was always calling him by these shortened versions of the name. He hadn't got the kind of dignity or persona that would you would call ex cathedra. So naturally they always did address him in these endearing terms. And they ripped it off. Well, there was a terrible scream and he shouted, "Help!" You see. Actually, his words were aidez-moi, because he used the French version, you see.
Clement Freud has challenged. Why?
Deviation.
Why?
Well, if he was a German.
He couldn't have been. Actually,
he wouldn't have said aidez-moi.
But he could have said, even if he was a German, he still could have said aidez-moi. Actually, early on, he said, "Get it off, Nick," which was English, wasn't it?
Yeah.
So he's been using more than one language. Clement, you have a point. 4 seconds, St. Nicholas, starting now.
Hagiographers all over the world will tell you.
Kenneth Lewis has challenged.
Why is this blindness all with science, hagiographers? What's this mean? I don't know what he's talking to you now.
It is in English, at any rate. You were spouting German and French. And
yes, I know. He wasn't deviating from the subject of St. Nicholas. Clement, you have a point and two seconds on the subject starting now.
St. Nicholas on the fifth.
Clement Freud was then speaking when the whistle went, so he has taken the lead at the end of that round, and Aimi MacDonald is now in second place. And Clement Freud, will you begin the subject, Goodwill? Will you show some of the goodwill that we all expect at this time of year in 60 seconds, starting now?
When you buy a downtrodden cafe on the Great West Road, for which the lease is £4,593, there's always a sum which the estate agent expects you to pay in respect of goodwill. The fact that no one has ever been in the establishment, that hardly anyone is likely to go there, that it is now on a bypass around which no one ever turns up, is beside the point. Goodwill, they say.
Peter Jones has challenged. Why?
He just said it was beside the point, so it must be a deviation.
Which is
must be. So he said it's beside the point.
Yes, what a difficult challenge. This one I will have to put to the audience because
No,
it
give
might...
it to him. Give it to him.
Well, I've got to be fair.
It's the season of goodwill.
Maybe
like
beside the point, but at the same time,
this is the season of goodwill. I would like you to give it to him.
All right, Kenneth has given you a point. You've given one to Peter Jones. Actually, I don't think. I don't think you've altogether given it to him, because I think it was a very, very good challenge. There are 30 seconds, Peter. Goodwill starting now.
I always think of my son, whose name is William, and we call him Will. I don't know whether he's good or not. Probably he isn't. At least.
Kenneth Williams,
he said he's not good. Then why call him Goodwill? I mean, it's ridiculous. The whole thing is ridiculous.
Yes,
far-fetched, tendentious.
Yes.
Tendentious indeed.
Yes.
And therefore,
his
totally alien to the spirit of goodwill, which is what we're discussing.
I agree with that.
Nice.
So you have.
Lovely chairman, beautiful fellow.
What a change. 23 seconds on goodwill with you, Kenneth, starting now.
This is the true reciprocity of human understanding. When we say, "Oh, lovely to see, have a cup of tea and an aspirin," we are not plugging anyone's trademark. Oh, no. We are doing what in England has become habitual when we want you to unbend, unwind, let your hair down.
Kenneth Kenneth Williams was then speaking when the whistle went, so he gained the extra point and he moved forward into third place ahead of Peter Jones, Aimi in second, Clement leading, and Aimi MacDonald, your turn to begin. And the subject, how I boiled my Christmas pudding. Would you talk about your Christmas pudding and how you boiled it for 60 seconds starting now?
I got all my ingredients and I placed them on top of the working top. And then I made sure my hands were clean and kneaded them all together in what is commonly known as a basin. I added a few spices and herbs, etc. And then I molded the whole...
Clement Freud is challenged.
Oh.
Why is your challenge, Clement?
Deviation, you can't put herbs into a
Clement, of course you probably don't put herbs in, but it's perfectly possible to put them in. And Aimi MacDonald obviously isn't
such
a good...
Not herbs.
Aimi MacDonald is not such a good cook as you are. And if she puts herbs in her Christmas pudding, I just hope she doesn't ask me round to have some of it. But she wasn't deviating from the subject. So, how I boiled my Christmas pudding, Aimi. 40 seconds to go.
I forgot that Clement was a cook, actually. You shouldn't have given me that one, you see.
Why?
Well, he obviously knows more about it than I do.
I know, but then he challenged you, and you've got the point, so I wouldn't worry. 40 seconds still with you, Aimi, starting now.
When I've got it all in the bowl, I mould it into a great round lump. Then I get another basin, a tin one.
Clement Freud has challenged.
Oh, basin,
why?
Yes.
The reputation of a basin.
Oh, yes, what a pity. I want to know what you did with all this. Remind me not to accept that invitation round your cooking, will you, Aimi? Right, 30 seconds with you now, Clement, on how I boiled my Christmas pudding, starting now.
There's a woman in Stratford St. Mary who boiled her Christmas pudding and became blind. I wish to know nothing of that, because the way I boil my Christmas pudding is the only authentic way. You get...
Peter Jones.
Repetition of way. The
yes.
way I do it is the only way.
That's right, yes.
Apart from being rather an arrogant remark, I thought...
I give you 1 point for a correct challenge. I can't give you one for arrogance of your opponent. There are 18 seconds on how I boiled my Christmas pudding, Peter, starting now.
Well, it is in the past tense, you notice, so I can describe the act of putting the saucepan on the gas stove with a portion of water in it, which has to have a bits of metal to keep the basin from hitting the base of the pan. Now...
Peter Jones was then speaking when the whistle went. He's now moved into third place. And, Peter, it's also your turn to begin. What I got for Christmas. Can you tell us what you received for Christmas in 60 seconds, starting now?
Well, it was something that I've been looking forward to getting for a very long time. And my wife and friends and relatives were all anxious for me to receive this gift. Now, it was supposed to be a surprise. And when I went to sleep on Christmas Eve, I had no idea that this was in store for me. Now, you understand that the relatives who journeyed from all corners of these islands to our house for this occasion were also in the dark, because the parcel which contained it was under the stairs, and we kept it a secret because the unveiling ceremony, which was due to be held.
And we will never know what he got for Christmas. He never got as far as the unveiling ceremony. Never heard of unwrapping a parcel referred to as an unveiling ceremony. If you keep going without being interrupted for 60 seconds, you gain a bonus point, which is just what Peter Jones has done, and the first person to do it for a number of weeks. Congratulations, Peter. You have moved forward again, but you are still 1 point behind our leader, who is still Clement Freud. Kenneth, will you begin? Party games. Can you give us some information, a few hints, or some inside knowledge on that subject in 60 seconds, starting now?
Here's a pencil and pad, and you won't find it bad. These games that we all of us know, pass them on as you write them, and add infinitum, it's just party games, make a good party go. Which was what someone once said to me on this subject. Now, hide the thimble. Quite amusing. Postman's knock. Very interesting. And the marvellous pin cushion. Now, this is probably the most intriguing of all. You have this playful instrument, which is designed so that, without being obvious in any way, there is a prick which will be felt on a certain occasion when you manipulate a tiny piece of wire. Now, you get somebody who's tremendously dignified to sit in this place, and then you press it, and they go, oh, yeah!
And as you said, press it, Clement Freud pressed his buzzer. What's the challenge, Clement?
Hesitation.
Nonsense. Five, and the audience say no as well. 5 seconds still with you, Kenneth, on party games, starting now.
Well, he's put me off terrible.
Clement Freud is challenged.
I feel terrible.
Clement, what was your challenge that time?
Deviation. That had nothing to do with party games.
It does. He was just going off and said he'd put me right off. It's one of those things. He was put right off, but he was still on the subject of party games. Some party games put you right off. There are 3 seconds for you, Kenneth, on party games, starting now.
Another kind of party game is when Lord...
Peter Jones has challenged. Why?
Repetition of another. He said another earlier on. He was describing the second
game. That's perfectly correct, Peter. You have 2 seconds on party games, starting now.
Get in a circle and...
Peter Jones was then speaking when the whistle went. He's now taken the lead over Clement Freud at the end of that round. Aimi MacDonald and Kenneth Williams are only a little way behind, equal in third place. Clement Freud, your turn to begin. Pick-me-ups. We have to have a question about food or drink for you, Clement, and this is obviously a topical one. Would you talk on it for 60 seconds, starting now?
Having had a particularly bibulous Christmas, I went to a doctor who said, open your mouth, put out your tongue, and he then looked at it and said, if I were you, I wouldn't put that back. Left me in a particularly distressing situation, so the following day, I decided to partake in a small exercise. My butler and I went into the withdrawing room, where each of us had a bottle of whiskey, which we drank, after which he went out and knocked on the door, and I had to guess who it was. This needed a pick-me-up of a very strong kind, and Worcester sauce, raw egg, Tabasco, red pepper, cayenne, salt, lemon juice, and vinegar were suggested to me, but rejected almost immediately and out of hand, because sterner and stronger stuff was quite clearly required before I would regain the equanimity with which I faced life in...
It is not often that we have 2 clear rounds in one particular game of Just a Minute, and Clement Freud has now achieved it. He gets the extra point for speaking when the whistle went. Aimi MacDonald, we come to you now, still on the same Christmas thoughts, taking down my decorations. Would you talk on that subject for 60 seconds, starting now?
It's very sad, really, to have to take down your decorations, but of course very necessary. First of all, you need one ladder. You get on the ladder and...
And Clement Freud has challenged.
Oh, I've done it again. Oh,
no. You need one ladder and you get on the ladder. Oh, dear. Well, maybe you'll get back, Aimi, but you did...
I'll catch you now.
Yes, I'm sure. It's 47 seconds with you, Clement, on taking down my decorations, starting now.
Walking into a famous West London store and carrying on my left jacket pocket both the insignia of the Victoria Cross and that of the Victoria...
Got you.
You Victoria.
Yes, definitely. I thought you were going to challenge on the fact that it was deviation because he hadn't got a Victoria Cross.
That's why I was asked to take them down.
It's all right. 37 seconds on taking. I realise that, but I hadn't got as far as saying it. 37 seconds on taking down my decorations, Aimi, starting now.
I climb up the steps and first of all have to unhook the balloons. To do this, you need a very small object with a little hook on the end of it in order to get the tacks out. This takes an awful lot of time.
Clement Freud is challenged.
There's no tacks on balloons.
The tacks were in the wall holding up the balloons as far
as I can make out. I mean, I know the government has gone berserk.
Bad luck, Clement. Aimi, you have a point and you have 22 seconds for taking down my decoration starting now.
This involves a great deal of trouble and you have to do it properly, otherwise you leave great holes in the wall. Then you have to take the other bits of decorations, which are all over the place, and you really can't be bothered. It's the last thing you want to do, it really is. And they're all
hesitation. You've challenged.
Hesitation?
Oh, yes. I'm afraid it was. The last thing you want to do, it really is. And having said it really is...
I was only breathing. Honestly, I was getting quite a flow. And it was going to be beautiful.
It was. We loved the pause. It was beautiful, but I'm afraid you mustn't do it quite so long in just a minute. So I agree with Kenny's challenge. He has 4 seconds on taking down my decorations, starting now.
Don't cause me any trouble at all. I leap into the air, grab them, and rip them all off.
Kenneth Williams is then speaking when the whistle went. He's got an extra point. It's still very, very close. Kenneth, will you begin? Where I put my Christmas cards. Could you tell us something about it in 60 seconds, starting now?
Here's your Christmas greeting, like a clarion call. If you do not like it, stick it on the wall. Once written on something sent to me. I actually did obey this injunction, and on the aforesaid place it was put. So, when later on the sender of this quite impudent message called, he did witness the act. I said, "Isn't it lovely there? It seems to suit the decor," because it was black and white. He said, "Yes, do you know it's after Beardsley?" I said, "Really? Is it? What's it actually depict?" He said, "The woman's with this little dog." I said, "Is it really a dog?"
Oh. No.
Repetition.
Of what?
Dog.
Yes, and there was a lot
of... I didn't actually say the word dog.
No, but you did say he said a number of times. I let you get away with it, Kenneth. There are 6 seconds for where I put my Christmas cards, Clement, starting now.
Whenever I get a Christmas card, I add my name to the bottom and send it to the next man who sent me a similar Christmas card.
Clement Freud... My New Year resolution. Now, as New Year is not very far away, we would love to hear, I hope we hear from all of them in this round, because I do want to know what some of their New Year resolutions are going to be. We start with you, Clement, 60 seconds, starting now.
My New Year resolution is to stop drinking, smoke no more, and give up women, because then I would live longer. But it was explained to me that it would only seem to be that much... So now my New Year's resolution is entirely different. I'm going to take upon me a great quantity of gold and silver and scatter it among the marketplaces of the cathedral cities of England. Wishing...
Kenneth Williams has a chance.
Oh, good.
Yes. Kenneth, we have 30 seconds on my New Year resolution starting now.
My New Year resolution is genuinely going to be to try to remove from my personality any malignance or wickedness.
Clement Freud has challenged. Why?
Deviation. There is no malignance or wickedness. You can't resolve to do the impossible.
Now, if I was to say that was an incorrect challenge, it would be very, very unfair to
Put
Kenneth.
Put it to the audience.
No, I can't, because they don't. They believe with you. They just clap that Kenneth hasn't got any malignance, but we want him to keep the subject.
Ah.
And as you're well in the lead, I think you can afford to do it, don't you?
Let him keep the subject.
Yes, let him keep the subject. All right, my New Year resolution is still with you, Kenneth, and there are 21 seconds left, starting now.
Resolution to forget hindsight and foresight, and like a puppy, throw yourself onto the new mown grass and just enjoy that moment. Stop thinking of the future, what's behind you, and surround the lovely ground.
Well, Kenneth Williams was then speaking when the whistle went, and speaking to good effect, so he gained a point which the audience applauded. By the way, just very briefly, Aimi and Peter, have you got a New Year resolution you'd like to pass on? No. All right. I will give you the final score now, because I'm afraid we have no more time to play. Just a minute. Aimi MacDonald this time finished in fourth place. She was just 2 points behind Peter Jones, who was in third place. He was 2 points behind Kenneth Williams, who was in second place, who was 2 points behind this week's winner, Clement Freud. Well, we do hope you enjoyed this edition of Just a Minute. And before I go, may I say, from all of us here, a very, very happy new year. And till we all meet again, goodbye.
The chairman of Just a Minute was Nicholas Parsons. The programme was devised by Ian Messiter and produced by David Hatch.
We present Kenneth Williams, Clement Freud, Peter Jones and Derek Nimmo in Just a Minute. And as the minute waltz fades away, here to tell you about it is our chairman, Nicholas Parsons.
Thank you very much. Hello and welcome to Just a Minute. In fact, this is a special edition of Just a Minute. It's a special Christmas edition. And I think you can already guess that our audience are in the Christmas mood and Christmas spirit. Our stage here at the Westminster Theatre in London is festooned with streamers. They've all got these funny little things that make a funny noise. Oh, they don't make any noise at all. I'm very sorry. In fact, Ian Messiter has said we should call it Just a Christmas, because all the subjects in the show are to do with Christmas. And who is more Christmassy than Kenneth Williams? So, Kenneth, as you create such bonhomie and fun everywhere, would you start the show this week? And the first subject, which I suppose could be called Christmassy, but certainly it's in keeping with when the four panelists have a go at me, Parson's nose. You do get some Parson's nose at Christmas, but you can take it whichever way you like. So can you try and speak for just a minute without hesitation, repetition, or deviation on that subject, starting now?
I have never actually eaten this part of the bird, but I understand it belongs to an unmentionable area. And though delectable, I am assured by those who have savored of it, I remain in total ignorance. I realize, of course, that Parson's nose could well be a reference to the patrician appendage on our chairman's face and that feature which has earned him so much admiration from the ladies. And not to mention several lasses I've seen hanging about who followed him all the way from Glasgow when he was, as you know, an apprentice shipwright, and never has he lost his affection for Caledonia and all the traditions of that country, which do not include...
Well, what a fine way to start our special Christmas edition of Just a Minute, with Kenneth starting with a subject and finishing without hesitating, repeating, or deviating. And, of course, he gets a point for speaking as the whistle went. In this case, it was one of those Christmas blowers that Ian Messiter used. And also, he gets a bonus point for not being interrupted. So at the end of that round, he is in a commanding lead. He's the only person to have scored any points. He must be in a commanding lead. So, Derek Nimmo, we go to the second subject for Christmas, stuffing a bird. Derek, will you tell us something with your sorted little Christmas hat perched on your delicate little protuberance there about stuffing a bird in 60 seconds, starting now?
Well, stuffing a bird is something that gastronomically I've never attempted, but otherwise perhaps I have. But I've always followed very much in the steps of the master, Nicholas Parsons, famous for his nose. There you cause all days came from Glasgow in the beginning, trundling down that weary way to the southern counties. He's kept with him the aptitude to be able to stuff a bird. And although he's now in his late 60s, he knows how a bird should be truly stuffed.
Peter Jones' challenge.
What?
Correction, he's only in his early 60s.
Some people think I haven't even reached them. But anyway, he was deviating by saying I was in my late 60s. And that, I can assure you, is not only a fact, but something I'm going to say to Peter Jones. You have a point for a correct challenge. And you take over the subject of stuffing a bird with 13 seconds to go, starting now.
I suppose they mean the turkey, a very overrated bird altogether. Not native to this country, of course, although they are reared in huge numbers in Norfolk. I've never stuffed one and never want to eat one, in fact. Because I don't find them particularly pleasant, and since I...
So, Peter Jones was speaking as the whistle went and gained that extra point, and for the other one in the round, he's now equal with Kenneth Williams in the lead, and he also takes the next round. Peter, will you tell us something about Christmas stocking in just a minute, starting now?
The beginning of December every year, I get this catalogue from a well-known shop in Bond Street, and it's full of the most extraordinary advertisements for things like pigskin boxes for putting lumps of sugar in to take down to give to your pony, and champagne whisks, and curious statistics regarding wine, which you can also machinery for pouring it once you've taken the cork out of your bottle with a peculiar kind of corkscrew, then you can pour it by turning this handle and it sort of levered over. It's very, very complicated. And for the... What was that?
A Clement Freud challenged you.
Oh, he did?
Yes. He hasn't mentioned a Christmas stocking.
No, he hasn't.
No, these are things you can put in your stocking.
You never actually said that, though, Peter.
I don't have to, do I? I don't spell it out. All these people understood me perfectly well.
Yes, but we have lots of listeners.
What's that?
That very rude noise, by the way, was only someone playing one of these blower things. Clement Freud, I agree with your challenge. He had not actually mentioned these were before the Christmas stocking.
No.
And there are 21 seconds left for Clement to talk on Christmas stocking, starting now.
In olden and prosperous days, people used to put pillowcases out so that parents and loved ones could fill them with presents. And then they became Christmas stockings and now socks, and any moment I expect British Airways slippers. Because as we have less money, more...
Kenneth Williams, challenge.
Well, it seemed to just drag to a halt, didn't it? Hesitation?
It did indeed. Yes, so that is also hesitation. And there are 1.5 seconds for you to tell us something about Christmas stocking, Kenneth, starting now.
I want mine to be stuffed in nylon running.
In this special Christmas edition of Just a Minute, Kenneth Williams has gaining points again, including one then for speaking as the whistle went.
Does that mean I'm winning?
Not only winning, but overacting.
Oh, God. It's the drink they give you, isn't it? I think it's the drink from the BBC.
Yes.
And not very good, that wine.
That's lovely. And of course, in Scotland, we usually celebrate Hogmanay Day, but I mean, there's a heaven. Let's go back to Just a Minute. Clement Freud, the next Christmas subject is mince pies. What a lovely thought. And will you tell us something about it in the game, starting now?
Mince pies are part of traditional Christmas fare and used, in fact, to contain real meat. Beef and mutton, which was mixed with suet, currants, sultanas, raisins, mixed orange, lemon and grapefruit peel are other ingredients which you're likely to get in a mince pie. And it's covered in a pastry which can be short or less so or puffed.
Yes, I think that's hesitation. A short, although so, it's a clever way to try and get out of it. He didn't quite achieve it. So Derek Nimmo has mince pies, and there are 27 seconds starting now.
Not many people know, but this is totally true, that a mince pie is emblematical of the manger in which our Lord was born. They used to put the mince, which was made, as we've already heard so graphically from Mr. Clement Freud, concoct the material they put.
Peter Jones has challenged.
Hesitation.
I would agree, Peter. So you've got the subject of mince pies, and there are 9 seconds left. You tell us something about them, starting now.
Mince pies is Cockney slang for eyes.
Clement Freud challenge.
Mince pies are.
No. when you're talking about Cockney slang, it's mince pies is Cockney rhyming slang for eyes, and that's what he was going to say. So he is correct. And you have another point for that, Peter. And you have 5 seconds on mince pies, starting now.
I hadn't expected to be corrected on a grammatical point by a parliamentarian.
Peter kept going till the whistle was blown by Ian Messiter again, telling us 60 seconds was up, and he gets the extra point for doing so, and he is in a lead at the end of the round. And Kenneth Williams, your turn to begin. Kenneth, a Christmas personality, I'm sure.
A what?
A what? I haven't said anything yet.
I can't hear with him blowing this toy in my ear.
I know.
What are you saying?
Have another drink, Kenneth.
I've had three already. I can't keep on sitting here drinking. It's ridiculous. What's the next one?
I know, it's not often that Clement gets so carried away he blows something in your ear. The subject is Charles Dickens. He wrote a lot about Christmas, but will you tell us something about that author in just a minute, starting now?
Well, perhaps one of the most famous of his stories does mention Christmas, because, you know, old Cratchit has terrible trouble, even with the ointment shoved on. He says continually that his travails are unceasing, and consequently the old Christmas carol is frequently used as an example, if you will, of two English attitudes which go on predominating. There are those who say, eat, drink, be merry, others, I'm not giving eightney to any gaiety, and sit and say that the occasion has nothing to do with festivity, but everything to do with the sober, the profound reaction to what is a religious observance, because mass.
So, once again, Kenneth took the subject at the start and carried on right through the 60 seconds without being interrupted or being hesitated or repeating himself, and gained an extra point for speaking as the whistle went, and one for not being interrupted, and he's now in second place, one behind Peter Jones. Derek, will you take the next round? The subject, crackers. Oh, what lovely Christmas fare. Will you tell us something about them in just a minute, starting now?
Crackers. Well, I don't see why we have to bring our chairman back into the game every time we have a subject, even though it happens to be Christmas. But I awfully liked, as a child, Crawford's cream crackers that I used to eat with Wellesleydale and Stilton and Cheshire, fine English cheeses. But of course, when you're sitting behind the tree, oh, shove off, Parson. When you're sitting behind the tree,
Coming for a challenge.
Repetition.
Of what?
Sitting.
So, Clement Freud had a correct challenge. The subject is crackers, Clement, and there are 33 seconds left, starting now.
It is the capital of Venezuela in South America.
Peter Jones has challenged.
No, it isn't.
No, it isn't.
Deviation.
It's not quite pronounced crackers.
It is, if you go there.
Well, it's a difficult decision to have to make.
No, it isn't at all. Quite easy.
Peter Jones has the benefit of my doubt. And he has crackers. And there are 28 and a half seconds, Peter, starting now.
Well, I've known a number of crackers in a very active life of pleasure. And perhaps one of the best was a girl called Myra, who lived in Perth in Western Australia. She really was a cracker.
Deviation.
Are we to believe that we're going to lower and demean the status of women by reducing them to this term, cracker? Are we going to sit here in an age celebrating Woman of the Year
Well, you have to keep going somehow in just a minute.
Most demeaning to the fair sex. I'm not going to sit here and listen to denigration. I can't bear denigration.
You're giving one of your best performances, Kenneth. Maybe this little Sheila out there in Perth really enjoy being called a cracker. Some of them do, you know, especially the Australians. So I don't think he was within the rules of our game. The reason for that laughter, listeners, was that Clement Freud, the least likely one, has thrown another streamer right across, and one has just hit me on the head and I'm sure increased my appearance. So I will now say Peter Jones an incorrect challenge. You continue with crackers and there are 16 seconds left, starting now.
I've done a great deal for feminism and I don't believe that Kenneth is really sincere when he hiccups his way into this program and berates me for describing the girl in Western
Australia.
Don't
talk about crackers at all if you talk about Kenneth Williams. Kenneth Williams is not a cracker.
Well, I dispute that.
But he was going at Kenneth Williams for him talking about the way he was referring to women
Kenneth
as crackers.
Kenneth Williams is not the subject on the card.
No, but crackers are, and he was still talking about crackers, to my mind. So,
oh, I see.
Yes.
Well, to your mind, that's different.
Oh, you see, they've definitely gone anti.
It's all changed, hasn't it?
Yeah.
You obviously want to hear from Derek Nimmo. You want to hear from Derek Nimmo, do you?
Yeah.
All right, I can be magnanimous. I can be full of Christmas spirit and say, Derek, you have a challenge, which I disagree with, but you have a point for that. And you have 6 seconds to, as Peter's in the lead, I can be generous to Peter. And crackers is the subject. 6 seconds starting now.
I hate when we call crackers. I always call them...
Clement Freud got in there first. Yes.
Repetition of hesitation.
Right. 5 seconds on crackers, Clement, starting now.
If you pull a cracker yourself and have a beard, it is extraordinarily dangerous because...
So Clement Freud was then speaking as the whistle went, and he has moved forward one ahead of Kenneth Williams, just behind our leader, Peter Jones. Derek Nimmo's in fourth place, and Peter begins the next round. Peter... Brandy butter. Will you tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
Well, it's an ideal thing to eat in large quantities if you want to commit suicide by cholesterol. If you smear it on chips, you'll have an almost certain chance of expiring before the meal is over. It's not very pleasant, of course, to eat in that context, or at least smeared on, as I said.
Clement Freud challenge.
Hesitation.
Yes, I thought you were going to have him for smear, but I think that was hesitation. All
he
right,
said
Clement.
Smear before.
Yes. 40 seconds on brandy butter starting now.
Brandy butter is certainly not the capital of any South American town, but it is...
Kenneth Williams' challenge.
What's he talking about, South American town? How can you have the capital of a South American town?
That is deviation, that's
what it is.
Yes.
Total deviation. You're only the capital of a country.
Exactly.
Not the capital of a town.
Don't make a meal of it.
Well, I mean, I know you've had a few, but you should still not slur diction. I mean,
Kenneth, put yourself together, which I know is not difficult for you, and with 35 seconds, tell us something about brandy butter, starting now.
Well, you know, when you've got your Christmas pudding, if you don't fancy the cream, brandy butter's gorgeous. It leavens it. And gives a nice sort of oleaginous touch because the pudding can be
Clement
a bit...
Freud has challenged.
Repetition of pudding.
Yes, you mentioned...
Well, I meant the pudding could be a bit dry, you know, at times.
So
that's
you mentioned pudding before, Kenneth, and that was repetition.
Well,
and
you're
Clement
right,
Freud has the subject. Clement Freud has the subject back of brandy butter. 18 seconds, starting now.
It's a very great mistake to try and make brandy butter in a liquidizer because it tends to curdle or churn the butter and you get a nasty, lumpy, gristly, gritty substance which does nothing at all for your Christmas pudding, which it should make smooth and...
Well, Clement Freud just kept going until the whistle went, and only just, but he did manage it. He kept got the point for speaking at that moment and has now taken the lead at the end of the round and also begins the next round, which is the delightful subject of pantomime. So, Clement, will you tell us something about pantomime in just a minute, starting now?
Pantomime is the sort of thing without which Christmas wouldn't be at all complete. Panto is an unusual singular, like graffito, raviolo, and spaghetto, which you can't...
Peter Jones's chum.
Hesitation and deviation.
Why?
Well, he hesitated. You heard that.
No, I didn't.
Well, then deviation, because he said that no Christmas was complete without it. Well, it's complete in Russia, North America, South America, all kinds of places they don't have pantomime, and their Christmases are as complete as any.
Well, I don't know. That's open to question. I think a British Christmas is more complete.
Who is talking about a British Christmas?
It doesn't matter.
Just because you're doing pantomime, you need to get a plug in all the time.
Well, yes, right.
Well, I am. I've got the skirts on again this year, playing Dave.
You never took them off, did you?
We're going. Dick Whittington, we're growing great guns down at Croydon. All right, Clement, I disagree with the challenge. It is still pantomime, and there are 47 seconds left, starting now.
I would like to tell people, though it's probably too late, that Nicholas Parsons will be appearing in Dick Whittington at Croydon. And I thought I would mention this in case it was cut from when he announced it himself just before I began to speak. He is playing the dame with boots and whiskers as a cat.
Yes, he did hesitate, because I complain of Dame of Boots and Whiskers and a cat. There are 27 seconds left for pantomime with you, Derek, starting
now. Well, as Nicholas Parsons comes on stage and Dick Whittington, they all shout, "Hello, Randy Butter," because... And they all look at him with gaze of extraordinary esteem, because they know that in those skirts lurks a man. A fellow with the very apparatus that is required for going about...
So Derek Nimmo got the point for speaking as the whistle went and got it in style and has moved forward. He's still in fourth place, just behind Kenneth Williams. Then we have Peter Jones, Clement Freud still in the lead, and Kenneth begins the next round. Robin Redbreast. Kenneth, will you tell us in this special Christmas edition of Just a Minute something about Robin Redbreast, starting now?
I had this scene in a pantomime where the Robin Redbreast was put onto a barrel, and then I had to say of the instrument beneath, "Here's a piano in the wood, a song and dance will do us good." And the little puppet, which of course was what the bird was actually made of, it was puppetry, you see, actually did sing, and the audience followed the lyric, which ran, "I had a little robin in the blackthorn tree, but with all his bobbing, he didn't sing for me." Now, many people found it sad, and some didn't join in, because they said, "Oh, this is a wrong song. Why don't we have the bees? Don't tease the bees, please. Don't tease the bees. These bees are very busy bees. I try to please
Clement,
life isn't easy for the poor dear bees."
Yeah. And before you got to your fifth bees, Clement Freud had challenged you.
Well, what's he on about, anyway?
Well, he wants to play Just a Minute, and he's got the subject back, and he's had another drink, and you've had another hiccup, and there are 9 seconds to go. Oh. And someone's cracked a dish, anyway, Robin Redbreast is the subject, Clement. 9 seconds, starting now.
It must be a sign of great stupidity on the part of a bird to remain in a cold climate, sitting on the branch of a tree with snow while ice forms around it.
So Clement Freud, now with more points, has increased his lead. Derek Nimmo takes the next round, and the subject is What My Aunt Gets for Christmas. What an interesting subject. Derek, will you tell us something about What My Aunt Gets for Christmas in 60 seconds, starting now?
My aunt actually lives in Lancashire, and what she gets depends whether Nicholas Parson is coming down from Scotland at the time. But what she will receive this year is a autographed copy of that fine autobiography, Just Williams, which is written by this most distinguished member of the panel who I have the privilege of sitting with today. He most kindly said that he would sign his name on the page of the aforementioned book for my dear aunt. What a wonderful prize. What a marvelous present, I thought, as I handed her £8.50, which is the price that you have to give for this actual publication. I will also give to her a turkey unstuffed, some oranges, apples, sugar, pears, peaches, lumps of coal, tissue paper, several knickers. What?
A Peter Jones is challenged.
Lumps of what?
Lumps coal. Of coal.
Oh,
coal.
I didn't hear
considered
that.
Good luck, don't you know? When you give a lump of coal, it's good luck.
Not if you're living in a centrally heated flat.
Well replied, Peter, but actually he wasn't deviating from the subject of what my aunt gets.
Yeah, but what was Kenneth on about? Why did he interrupt? What right has he got to say that?
Well, he didn't say anything for a long time because he was getting a plug for the book.
Yes, enough. That's another thing, yeah.
I suppose you'll be selling his book from the stage of the theatre in Croydon where you're appearing. Probably be auctioning it, will you?
No, I'm selling my own book from the stage of the theatre in Croydon.
Yes.
Egg on the Face, that one's called. And I've had plenty of that in my time. I get plenty of it in Just a Minute, and some of the stories are in Egg on the Face. Let us get back to Just a Minute. And, Derek, there are 12 seconds. What my aunt gets for Christmas, starting...
If I appear to be not listening, it's actually, I'm writing a book.
Oh, well, in just a minute, nothing if nepotism isn't rife. Derek, there are 11 seconds. What my aunt gets for Christmas, starting now.
What I will also be giving to my aunt at Christmas are chewing gum sleeves, all arrayed without their contents, because that sort of mystifies. Oh, God!
So what Derek's aunt gets for Christmas brings this special Christmas edition of Just a Minute to a close. So his aunt has not only achieved fame, but perhaps even immortality. Well, did you all have a good Christmas?
Yes!
Marvellous! And a happy new year to you all! Now, in third place, very fairly, Derek Nimmo and Kenneth Williams for Easter. They're now throwing the streamers as I give the final score. Peter Jones finished only 2 points ahead in second place, and only just 2 points ahead of him was our many times winner and our Christmas winner, Clement Freud. Well, to all our patient audience here in the studio, we thank you for braving the winter storms and the snow and slush and coming out and sitting and being our audience here. We thank you very much, and we do hope you had a lovely Christmas. And so from all of us here, God bless and thank you!
The chairman of Just a Minute was Nicholas Parsons. The programme was devised by Ian Messiter and produced by Pete Atkin.
Welcome to Just a Minute. My name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, once more it is my pleasure to welcome the four exciting, talented people who are going to play Just a Minute. We welcome back three of our regular players of the game, that is Derek Nimmo, Peter Jones, and Clement Freud, and someone who has only played the game occasionally, Stephen Fry. Would you please welcome all four of them? beside me sits Liz Trott, who's going to keep the score and blow a whistle when the 60 seconds are up. And this edition of Just a Minute is being specially recorded for Christmas Eve. So I think probably there'll be a great Christmas feel about the show. And as usual, I'm going to ask the four panellists to speak on the subject that I give them, and they will try and do that without hesitation, repetition, or deviating from the subject. And we'll begin this special Christmas edition with Clement Freud. Clement, will you talk about my favourite Christmas present? 60 seconds, as usual, starting now.
My favourite Christmas present, I was going to suggest, would be a pipe of port, until I found that that contained over 800 bottles. And I think, on the whole, I would prefer something that didn't take up as much room. So perhaps a voucher, what my grandchildren call a vulture. Like going to Paris on Eurostar and being able to have lunch at Amic.
Derek Nimmo, challenge.
Hesitation.
Yes, there was a definite there. So, Derek Nimmo, you get a point for a correct challenge. You take over the subject. There are 33 seconds left. My favourite Christmas present.
My favourite Christmas present was given to me a few years ago by my wife. It's a beautiful walnut bureau bookcase of 18th century origin. Probably Queen Anne or...
Peter Jones challenged.
There was a bit of a hesitation.
There was a hesitation, definitely. Absolutely, Peter. Yeah. A point to you and the subject, 23 seconds, my favourite Christmas present.
That was an electric train which my Uncle Harry gave me, and it was surrounded by a farmyard which my father contributed, and it was a marvellous toy. It was a...
Derek Nimmo got in first. Yes, repetition. It was 13 seconds. My favourite Christmas present, Derek, starting now.
When you open the flat, there are all kinds of secret drawers inside it.
Stephen Fry.
This is just disgusting. Talking about his wife here. I remember something about his wife giving him a present and then talking about opening her flap and finding her drawers. Horrific.
It is.
For Christmas,
but,
I mean.
I agree. I mean, it is a very devious thought, but he wasn't deviating the rules of Just a Minute. So Derry gets a point because it was an incorrect challenge and keeps the subject. 8 seconds, my favourite Christmas present starting
it
now.
It has two doors made of grey glass. They weren't that colour originally, but rather like in 13th Corinthians when you say, now I see through what's
that? Well, I don't know what that was, but it was...
There's a little bit of extra...
13th of the
Yes, we interpret it as hesitation. Steve, and so you've got in with 2 seconds to go on this subject. My favourite Christmas present starting now.
My favourite... Oh, very
and
good.
Clement Freud child.
Hesitation, I thought.
Rubbish!
My favourite Christmas present... I'm going to start before you start the clock now because I'm so scared of the whole thing.
It was actually 1.5 seconds to go, and of course, whoever is speaking when the whistle goes gains an extra point. And it was Stephen Fry, who was in second place at the end of the round behind Derek and Nimmo. Peter Jones, what about you taking this one? Who I would like to kiss under the mistletoe? Clement has challenged.
Deviation.
Why?
Who? Whom I would like to kiss.
Peter Jones, would you like to talk on whom I would like to kiss under the mistletoe for 60 seconds, starting now?
I'd want to clear this with my wife of 40 years, and I don't think there are many people that she would find acceptable. The Queen Mother, perhaps, would be a good choice, but then one would have to get the permission of Buckingham Palace.
Derek Nimmo, challenge.
Condition of permission.
Yes, you had to get your wife's permission first, and now...
I thought he said I had to clear this with my wife.
Clear this with my wife. I didn't say permission.
I think he said permission.
No, right. No,
no. I don't think.
Well done.
It wouldn't be correct, because we have a very kind of open relationship.
Yes, it's amazing how much of their life comes out in just a minute. Peter, you have an incorrect challenge, so you get a point, and you keep the subject. There are 47 seconds left. Whom I would like to kiss under the mistletoe, starting now.
Whether it would be at her place or mine would have to be arranged between us. There would be no...
Clement Freud challenge.
Too many woods.
Too many woods. You were saying wood this and wood that.
Yes.
We let a few go, but I think...
Well...
Clement, a correct challenge, 41 seconds left. Whom I would like to kiss under the mistletoe, starting now.
A mistletoe is a unisexual parasitic evergreen, rather like Nicholas Parsons. And...
Derek Nimmo challenge?
Well, he just sort of stopped.
That was enough.
It's called a contribution. Yes. I don't know why.
It's very well received, I must say. I like it actually very much.
Derek, a correct challenge. 29 seconds. Whom I would like to kiss under the mistletoe starting now.
I would like to kiss Miss Frieda Baring of 10 Caravan Park, Nickeldale Lane, Billthorpe, near Newark, Nottingham. I've had a huge passion for this lady for many years, since I first saw her at the Adelphi Theatre 21. That's a year ago, never mind. It's all gone, never mind.
There's a hesitation in the service of avoiding a repetition, which is always...
Right. Stephen, sad. 11 seconds, whom I would like to kiss under the mistletoe.
Well, like an enormous number of people. Of course, Douglas Hurd features at the top of my list. One surely of the most snoggable men the century has ever given birth to. Close after him, you'd have to put Stephen Hendry, and after that, I suppose...
Clement Freud, your challenge.
Repetition.
Or what?
After.
Oh, after, God, right. Like Clement, it. A correct challenge, and 2 seconds on whom I would like to kiss under the mistletoe, starting now.
I think nobody on this platform.
Oh! No, Stephen actually got in before the whistle, Stephen.
Well, there was a kind of second between
there
platform and whistle.
There was a definite hesitation, Stephen.
As there were only 2 seconds which I was left with.
I know, but you did stop before the whistle, and Stephen got in, and he's done unto you what you tried to do to him. And there's half a second, Stephen, for you to tell us about whom you would like to kiss under the mistletoe starting now.
Emma Freud, obviously.
So Stephen Fry was once again speaking as a whistle when gained the extra point for doing so. And Derek, it's your turn to begin. Where I hang my stocking. 60 seconds. In one of those flaps you were referring to before, perhaps, I don't know. Starting now.
I always like my stockings well hung, so I hang them out about 8 days before Christmas so they're suitably ripe by the time the great feast arrives, Yuletide or whatever. Then I take them indoors, put them in the airing cupboard for a moment or two, and then go into the bedroom. Now, it depends which room I'm in, because in the country I have a 4-post, and it's very difficult to put them on the top of the newel post. There, how? If I'm in London, I hang them...
Peter Jones, a chat.
What do you mean, there, how? What did that mean?
It's a sort of... When you've sort of lost rubbish, you say things like that, don't you?
It's a bit of Northampton.
Deviation from English as we understand it, or is it normally spoken?
Yes.
Peter, correct challenge. 35 seconds are available. Where I hang my stocking, starting now.
Well, it happens to be where I am at the time. If I were in the Holiday Inn in Ottawa, I should hang my stocking there. There'd be little chance of it ever being filled by anybody because there's no one there I know at all. But if I were somewhere else...
Clement Freud challenge.
If I were.
Is if I were. Clement, a correct challenge. 19 seconds. Where I hang my stocking, starting now.
I am opposed to hanging, and I don't wear stockings. But having said that, it is only fair to announce that I would hang them from my suspender.
Stephen Fry, challenge.
A little bit of a hesitation.
Yes, after his suspender, yes. 6 seconds available. Where I hang my stocking, Stephen, starting now.
Well, I'm a bit of an old traditionalist. I like to hang it on the mantelpiece of my bedroom and wait for Santa to fill it any night.
Peter Jones.
That was a bit of a hesitation.
I think so too, Peter. You've got him with 1 second to go on where I hang my stocking, starting now.
For Ottawa.
Peter Jones is then speaking as the whistle went, and he's now taken the lead. Stephen Fry, will you take the next round? How I like to spend Christmas Day. 60 seconds to tell us, starting now.
Ah, how I'd like to spend Christmas Day. Well, snogging Douglas Hurd, obviously, but there are other things to be done. I have a large party of guests for Christmas, and, of course, I like to hesitate, as I just did, and I like also to...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Self-confessed hesitation.
Self-admission. Oh, Stephen. 50 seconds. How I like to spend Christmas Day, Derek, starting now.
I like to spend Christmas Day in a totally traditional way, surrounded by children and grandchildren. I will be in the country. They will all be sitting at my knee first thing in the morning to open their stockings. A tremendous ceremony, this. We go through the...
Stephen,
unless his home in the country is in Japan, I think that was a deviation of some kind.
36 seconds for you, Stephen, on how I like to spend Christmas Day, starting now.
I have to inspect the Argo first thing, because I left the turkey in overnight, and check that it hasn't dried up, which is the thing that happened.
Clement Freud challenge.
2 checks.
You check too much.
So bad at this. Sorry.
Clement, there are 31 seconds on how I like to spend Christmas Day starting now.
Putting a Czech turkey in an aga is a silly way to spend Christmas Day. But what I quite enjoy doing is placing the bird in an oven on the previous night, which would be this evening if you're listening to the original recording, although the repeat could well backdate.
Stephen,
this is just agony. It's just agony.
I was wondering.
We're listening to a turkey cooking overnight here. A butterball turkey.
Stephen, you got him with the correct challenge. You have 12 seconds to tell us more about how I like to spend Christmas Day starting now.
I expect Clement will put me right here, but I'd like to bung the giblets, make a stock, and then to get some kind of chestnut soup going, bubbling away at the back of this said cooker, stove, range, or whatever you like to call it. And meanwhile, there are people to entertain, stockings to open, all kinds of stuff to do.
So Stephen Fry was then speaking as the whistle went, gained an extra point for doing so, and with other points in that round, he's now taken the lead. And Clement Freud, it's your turn to begin. The subject, brandy butter. Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
Brandy butter is what you would add to Christmas pudding if you think there is, in that delicacy, an insufficient...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
He stopped.
Yes, well, here's it. Derek, 53 seconds available to you on brandy butter, starting now.
I'm frightfully keen on brandy butter, as long as there's a lot of cognac within it. I would know to... What's your...
I'm afraid we're back in Nagasaki or wherever it is now.
47 seconds, Stephen. Brandy butter, starting now.
Well, I'm sort of with what I assume was the tenor and thrust of Clement's earlier comment, which is that, frankly, Christmas pudding to me doesn't need any enriching, especially with sugary things. I prefer cream, but brandy butter is much loved by many. I suppose I ought to repeat now so that in some way Clement can interrupt me and give me a good recipe.
Clement Freud, challenge.
Repetition of Clement.
Yes.
That's it. You spotted it. Good.
So he wants to hear more about your brandy butter. 33 seconds left, Clement, starting now.
There are really two ways of doing this, and the first one is to get butter and put brandy into it, which you can do with a wooden spoon, especially if the butter is soft. But
Derek Nimmo, challenge.
Repetition of butter.
No, it's brandy butter.
Brandy butter.
Oh, I see.
We've only been playing the game for 28 years. But can I remind you, you can repeat the words on the card, which Clement did. 23 seconds, brandy butter, Clement, starting now.
But preferred methodology is to take the butter and whisk it.
Stephen, your lights came on, but there was no buzz.
No, he didn't mean it.
It was a hesitancy.
It was a mistake.
But I just go like that. You see, it lights up. The audience can see it light up, but it doesn't actually buzz. I have to do that to buzz it.
Anyway, I can assure all the listeners that Stephen Fry's light did come on, though he didn't press his buzzer very hard. What was your challenge?
Well, he just seemed to be hesitating a little, but it's so long ago that I've forgotten. I should go back to
I don't think he hesitated enough, Stephen. 17 seconds, Clement. Brandy butter, starting now.
Counts.
Peter Jones' challenge.
Hesitation.
He did hesitate then, yes. 15 and a half seconds, brandy butter with you, Peter, starting now.
I think you should all know that you can make whiskey butter or rum butter or even Tizer butter by the same method. So you just mix it up with the butter, add a little sugar if you don't think it's sweet enough, and then put it in the fridge until the time comes to serve the Christmas pudding.
Peter Jones was then speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point. He's now equal with Stephen Fry in the lead. And, Peter, it's your turn to begin. The subject, how to avoid a family argument on Christmas Day. Oh, a lot of people are laughing in the audience. They seem to be familiar ground. 60 seconds, as always, Peter, starting now.
Give everybody in the house, first thing in the morning, a large glass of orange juice, well laced with tranquilizers. This way, you'll have a lot of peace for most of the day, and if they need topping up, then that's what you'll do. You'll get a family-size box of these little pills, which can be bought in the black market fairly cheaply, and if that doesn't work, then...
Stephen Fry,
I just sensed a bit of hesitation there. I'm probably being over-strict.
I think you were, yes.
Yes, I think I probably am, yes.
I think you're being a bit over-keen, yes.
Yeah, I think so, yes. Carry on, Peter.
So, an incorrect challenge, Peter, another point. 35 seconds.
Did you not see my light go on?
I definitely didn't see your light go on, Clement. Yeah. 35 seconds, Peter. How to avoid a family argument on Christmas Day?
The other way is to go and live somewhere else on your own, in a caravan. You can avoid it in Sydney, in Australia. There are cruises that leave the bank...
Derek Nimmo.
Hesitation.
There was yes, a nerve right. there, Peter, yes. 24 seconds, Derek. How to avoid a family argument on Christmas Day, starting now.
I think I agree with Peter. The best thing is to go as far away as possible, possibly to Ho Chi Minh City, which used to be called Saigon, and you would have very few friends there and certainly no family. That would be the absolute ideal way of avoiding an...
Peter Jones has challenged.
I have an aunt in Ho Chi Minh City.
The point is, she's not related to me.
So you've answered his challenge, Derek, but give Peter a bonus point. 9 seconds available, Derek. How to avoid a family argument on Christmas Day, starting now.
Then I would stay in my bed the whole of the day, right the way through.
Clement Freud challenge.
Repetition of day.
Well, yes. It's on the card,
Christmas.
Actually.
It's on the card.
Wake
Christmas
up,
day.
Nicholas. You nearly gave it to him.
Derek, another incorrect challenge, another point to you. 5 seconds still available. How to avoid a family argument on Christmas Day, starting now.
If you don't speak at all, then nobody can have any kind of row with you, particularly if you are in...
So, at the end of that round, Derek Nimmo got the point, speaking as whistle went. It's very even, actually. There's only about 1 point separating all of them, but Peter Jones is just in the lead. Derek, your turn to begin, keeping the Christmas theme going. How Father Christmas Gets Down the Chimney is the subject. Just a minute, starting now.
How Father Christmas Gets Down the Chimney, with difficulty, I would say. It is one of the great puzzlements, but he always does it so kind, after weeks and days of tremendous...
Peter Jones, there was a hesitation.
There was a hesitation in the weeks and the days. Yes, I agree, Peter. 49 seconds. How Father Christmas Gets Down the Chimney, starting now.
Really, quite easily, because anybody who can get 4 reindeers onto the roof will have no problem getting down the chimney, with or without difficulty, who is one of the leading reindeers.
Clement Freud challenged.
It's the fifth reindeer.
you had some reindeer before.
Oh, did I?
Yes.
Mm.
So,
yes,
Clement,
I did. Yes.
You have a repetition challenge and 37 seconds to tell us something about how Father Christmas gets down the chimney, starting now.
In a word, smoothly. And having come down the chimney, he then prepares turkey ding, which is what he...
steam and
fire. Sorry, challenge. I thought he'd stopped there, but he wasn't. He was carrying on.
It was hesitation.
It was hesitation, wasn't it? Yes.
28 seconds.
You will never
available.
Know how to make turkey ding. You will be sorry about it.
I will be sorry, won't I? So I'll repeat myself very subtly. I may say your name again twice.
28 seconds for you, Stephen. How Father Christmas Gets Down the Chimney, starting now.
Well, in a word, perhaps sootily, unless, of course, people don't...
Derek Nimmo.
Sootily,
Da. Da. He's on the case, isn't he?
Yes,
take it away from him.
25
he's
seconds
mean,
for you on the subject,
right.
Derek. Starting now.
I think it's very kind of Muhammad Al-Fayed to allow him out for the day when he's been slaving in the house for all those months in advance. And I...
Clement Freud challenge.
Deviation.
Why?
I don't believe in Al-Fayed.
Bonus point to Clement because we enjoyed the challenge, but he wasn't actually deviating. So it's 17 seconds available still for you, Derek, on the subject, starting now.
But thankfully, Father Christmas always does get down. And with his jolly face and a great sack of toys, he goes to my stocking, fills it up, puts a mince pie beside it, drinks the glass of sherry, which I've left for him, and then goes up...
Peter Jones challenge.
Father Christmas doesn't put the mince pie there. He takes the mince pie. If you're generous enough to give him one. Isn't that right?
Well, I don't know. I mean, this... Yes! I think the audience wants you to win, Peter.
Very nice.
So, all right, they've decided, this audience, in their wisdom, has decided that it's Father Christmas is given a mince pie. He doesn't leave one. So you've got him with 2 seconds to go on how Father Christmas gets down the chimney, Peter, starting now.
Slides down, just like a weight being dropped.
End of of that round, Peter Jones is still in the lead. He's three ahead of Derek Nimmo, and then Clement Freud and Stephen Fry, one behind him. Stephen, your turn to begin. The subject, the worst Christmas cracker joke. I don't know whether you can remember any of them, but please try and talk on the subject. 60 seconds as usual, starting now.
Everyone, last year, how many ears has Davy Crockett got? Answer, three. A left ear, a right lug, and a front ear. Which, of course, is not a repetition of the auricular organ because it's a single word. Another one which I liked was, how do monkeys make toast? The answer to that one is they put it under a gorilla. While in the jungle, why is there no aspirin there? Because the parrots eat them all.
Kevin Floyd challenged.
It's enough.
I'm afraid the audience came in so quickly I didn't hear what you said, Clement. I would love to know what it was.
It just said, enough.
Enough? Oh, no, give him a bonus point for a good challenge, but...
Nicholas, if you can't hear as well as everything else, you really ought to retire.
Stephen Fry.
Yes.
You've got a point for an incorrect challenge. Kermit Freud got one, a bonus point for... because the audience enjoyed his challenge, which I couldn't hear. And there are 30 seconds left on the worst Christmas cracker jokes, starting now.
I suppose the worst Christmas cracker joke would be to have Frank Carson point at the cracker on your plate and go, hey, that's a cracker. But, there are others.
Kermit Freud challenged.
Hesitation.
No.
He was...
23 seconds.
He was riding a laugh.
Yes. The worst Christmas cracker joke, starting now.
There was one which said, I won't say it was a small town, but the speed limit signs were back to reverse. That doesn't make any sense. I would have had to repeat back. How terribly unfortunate.
Peter Jones, a challenge.
Hesitation.
Yes. Peter, 16 seconds for you to tell us the worst Christmas cracker joke, starting now.
Vicar at the village concert. Miss Brown will now sing when I am in my little bed, accompanied by the curate.
Clement Freud challenge.
Hesitation.
Yes, Clement.
Well, no, I just stopped.
No. You waited for your laugh and you got it. Clement, 7 seconds. Tell us the worst Christmas cracker joke, starting now.
It's no good going to bed early to save candles if the result is twins. Could be just about...
Clement Freud, speaking as a whistle, when gained that extra point. Clement, your turn to begin. The subject is Twelfth Night. Will you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
Twelfth Night is...
yes, Stephen.
Bit of hesitation there. It was early. I'm sorry. Was that cruel?
It was cruel, but it was correct.
Oh, I didn't mean to be cruel.
No.
It's a season of goodwill.
No.
I'll give it back to you after a bit, Clement.
No, he's been very tough with you.
59 and a half seconds to go.
Yes, quite. I'm going to last the course, I might be honest.
57 and a half seconds, Twelfth Night, Stephen, starting now.
Generally known as one of Shakespeare's festive comedies, subtitled, of course, What You Will, and set in Illyria, and starring, if that's the right word, personnel including Olivia and Viola and Tudston and Andrew Cruikshank and nowhere to come, be right, Eguchi.
Yes. Clement, yes.
It's a repetition of the ho. Ho, ho, ho.
Ho, ho, ho. He was laughing his own joke of Andrew Cruikshank. 48 seconds for you, Clement, on Twelfth Night, starting now.
January the 6th, or the Feast of the Epiphany is what Twelfth Night is about, but also, as my friend and colleague on my right said so very properly, a Shakespeare play written in 1601, starring...
Stephen Fry.
I didn't say properly that it was a Shakespeare play written in 1601. he ran the sentence on. I didn't hear any punctuation in his speech there, as my friend... I mean, admittedly, Clement is not...
No. Yeah, I think you made a point. It was, I think, a very subtle challenge, but it is correct. Stephen, you have the subject, 34 seconds, Twelfth Night, starting now.
I'm grateful to Sir Clement for the intelligence that Twelfth Night was written in 1601, which I was ignorant of, I'm afraid, and I will now hand him back by saying Clement again.
It's a new way of playing just a minute. They sit together and they hand it back and forth between each other. 26 seconds for you, Clement, on Twelfth Night, starting now.
I think Malvolio is a part that might have been written for Stephen Fry. It is, in many ways, the ideal role
for an actor of his size and sensibility. The twins, on the other hand, should not be played by Peter Jones and Derek Nimmo, because only one of them was male, the other, called Viola, who had this attachment to the Duke, should, I think, on all accounts, be performed.
Peter Jones got in.
Hesitation.
Yes, on the performed. And you've got in with a second to go, Peter, wow. On 12th night, starting now.
It's the night after the 11th.
So, at the end of that round, Peter Jones was speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point. And at the end of this special Christmas edition of Just a Minute, we have a very interesting result. We have three people equal in second place. That is Stephen Fry, Clement Freud, and Derek Nimmo. But 3 points ahead of them was our winner, Peter Jones! For me to say on behalf of our four exciting and talented players of the game, that is Clement Freud, Derek Nimmo, Peter Jones and Stephen Fry, Liz Trott, who's kept the score so well, Ian Besseter for having thought of the game and keeping us in work, and Anne Jobson, who has directed the show, and from myself also, Nicholas Parsons, on behalf of all of us, I must wish you a very happy Christmas. From all of us here, goodbye! Welcome to Just a Minute. My name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, it's my huge pleasure to welcome our many listeners, not only in this country, but throughout the world, but also to welcome to the show four exciting, dramatic, talented players of this game. And they are seated on my right. We welcome back with huge pleasure that outstanding comedian Paul Merton. And seated beside him, we have a fine broadcaster and good actor, Charles Collingwood. And seated on my left, we have that delightful and outrageous comedian and also a fine presenter, Graham Norton. And seated beside him, we have a lovely comedian and a gorgeous-looking creature, that is Shapik or Sandy. And would you please welcome all four of them? Seated beside me is Sarah Sharp, who's going to help me with the score and blow the whistle when the 60 seconds have elapsed. And this particular edition of Just a Minute is coming from the Radio Theatre in the heart of Broadcasting House, which is in the heart of this great metropolis of London. And we begin with Graham Norton. Graham, yes, oh, very topical. My New Year's resolution. So I don't know whether you've made any yet, Graham, but... 60 seconds starting now.
This year, I resolve to live my whole life according to the rules of Just a Minute. I shall not deviate.
Oh, wait a minute, Paul Challenge.
Well, it's deviation. You can't live your whole life because you've reached this point now. So you can't live your whole life in the past according to the rules of Just a Minute. I could lead my future life, but not my whole life.
Because the rest of it's gone. That's done. That's did.
But, Graham, I'm going to defend you on this one. It's all
right. Thanks, Nicholas. Get in there. Go on. Hit him.
I can see your logic.
Yes.
It might have been more easy, more explained if he said his future life.
Yes.
But it conveyed to me he'd had his life up to then, but in future he was going to lead his life in this way. And I think it was quite logical. So he gets the benefit of the doubt. And you keep the subject, Graham, and you have 52 seconds still available on my New Year's resolution starting now.
My New Year's resolution is slightly up in the air now. Not quite sure where I'm going with
Shappy the... Challenge.
I kind of read the air as a hesitation.
Did you?
No. No, I don't think so, Shappy. No, no, I think that's being a little bit too pedantic.
I'm sorry.
That's why.
You said
I know I did.
Do you think you hesitated?
No.
No. He was dragging out his words, but not enough for hesitation. Right, 44 seconds are still available, Graham. Tell us more about my New Year's resolution starting now.
My New Year's resolution is terribly exciting, but a bit of a secret, so I'm just able to hint at it. Do forgive me if I don't be very specific over the next however many seconds I have left to talk. I will, of course, make overt and slightly odd...
Paul challenge.
There was a slight hesitation.
There was a hesitation there, yes, yes. Paul, correct challenge. You have 28 seconds. Tell us something about my New Year's resolution starting now.
Is to put the final payment down on my sex change operation. By February, I hope to be a man. My former name, Eileen Jacobs, was something that didn't suit me in show business.
Charles challenge.
Well, it didn't suit me in show.
I think that was a hesitation, yes. Charles, yes. 19 seconds. You tell us something about my New Year's resolution starting now.
My New Year's resolution is to stop drinking as much as...
Paul yeah. challenge.
Deviation, he's talking like a pirate.
My New Year's resolution.
Since when has Charles been a pirate? Does he play a pirate in the Archers?
That sheep needs shearing.
I have never been so insulted in my voice like that to be called a pirate.
16 seconds starting now.
If only I could be born a little boy, I would just say to Mummy, my New Year's resolution is to give up my sweeties. But I'm not a little boy.
I nearly buzzed you on the first little boy, because you can't be born a little boy. You're born a baby, then you grow into a little boy. But I didn't, and then I waited, and that's good.
And you got him on repetition of
little boy. You're not born a big something.
No, you're born a baby.
Who's a little boy?
No, babies are babies. They're like little pterodactyls. They're not... They don't solidify.
Are they not born with sexual organs?
But whatever, Paul, they don't come out of the womb going, I want to give up my sweeties.
That does seem a bit developed, doesn't it?
I thought so, yes.
Shappy, you had a correct challenge. You have 5 seconds. Tell us something about my New Year's resolution starting now.
My New Year's resolution is to avoid smokers throughout January and not hear them whinging, I can't believe I had a...
In this game, whoever is speaking when the whistle goes gains an extra point. On this occasion, with Shappy for Sandy, who's got 2 points, but then so is Charles and Connie, Will and Graham Norton. Paul's only got one, and that's the situation. End of the first round. Charles, Connie, would you take the second round? The subject is how to flirt. Tell us something about that in this game, starting now.
I met a pirate recently who said to me, I was in this port and I saw this young girl. I said, come here, warrior. I do not fancy you. That was rather unsubtle flirting. For myself, I do the more a subtle approach.
Chaffee challenge.
I'm sorry, was that hesitation? Yes, I feel bad because I was enjoying what you were saying as well as a pirate.
Well, you shouldn't have interrupted.
It's my finger. It's just my competitive nature.
Darling,
I'm sorry.
Address it to me and I'll decide.
I'm sorry, Nicholas. I felt like he hesitated.
He did. Well done. Well done. 47 seconds available for view, Shappy, on how to flirt, starting now.
I've never been very good at flirting. In fact, I didn't get a boyfriend till I was 23, because when I met someone I fancied, I was very likely to say something like, hello, I like fish, which made men run away from me very fast indeed. And also, what I did when I was a teenager, which I thought was hilarious, but the men that I liked didn't, was I used to lick my finger, touch them, and go, let me get you out of those wet clothes. Now, I thought that was amusing, but they never amusing at all, and I've said that twice. Let's see if anyone notices. Now, I always thought that flirting was something kind of culturally specific, and I have noticed that English guys, when they flirt, they look at you, and then when you catch their eye, they look away. And now I realise they weren't flirting at all. They just happened to be casting their eye around a bar, and me...
So, Shappy, because Sandy was not only speaking when the whistle went, she gained other points in the round, and she is in a strong lead at the end of that round.
I shared too much, though.
What's that?
I felt like I shared too much. Suddenly, I felt really exposed and icky.
Well, hey, Shappy, that went clothesline, I'm using.
Shappy, I don't know whether you've exhausted all the points you had, because it's your turn to begin the next round. It is how to deal with admirers. You use some of the material that would have fitted the other one, wouldn't it? Right.
I don't know why I hold the buzzer when it's my turn. That's low self-esteem, that is.
I think it's a good idea to always keep it in your hand.
Okay.
Right. So,
You'll learn as you get older.
Shappy, how to deal with admirers, 60 seconds, starting now.
How to deal with admirers. It's not something that I've had to deal with very often in my life. I wish I'd had to do it more often. What I find...
Paul, challenge.
A repetition of often.
Too many oftens, yes, then. Shappy. Right. So, Paul, a correct challenge. There are 53 seconds available. How to deal with admirers, starting now.
One gives a shy smile, lowers the eyes to the pavement, perhaps lifts the hat as if to say, thank you for your kind approbation. I understand that I mean a great deal to you via the television set and also radio, but you must understand that I cannot give my love to all my listeners and viewers. Well, all right, we'll start with you. And so... We talk to our admirers. Nicholas Parsons has many admirers, stretching all the way back to Charlemagne, a magnificent man who reorganised Sweden into 16th century Europe and set forward the democracy that we see now in that particular benighted part of the land. When I think of my admirers, I can see here the front row. They've come all the way from Hartlepool to listen to the golden words honeying from my lips. They may say to themselves, he is a Londoner. We must look up to him. But then other people say, why? Why? People in London, they should.
Well, not only.
Fan base.
I know. Not only a deserved round of applause for keeping going for the full 60 seconds, Paul, oh, almost 60 seconds, but the point is that man left just as you wanted him. Leapt out of his seat in the front row and shot out.
Perhaps you remembered the Christmas timetable for trains to Hartlepool.
I'll give Graham a bonus point for that one. But, and it's actually your turn to begin, Paul. Oh, yes. Oh, very Christmassy. Well, it's gone, I know, but, I mean, it's still... Well, I mean, we like to remind it, because it's the subject is what I got for Christmas. So, Paul, can you tell us what you got? It's terrible English on some of these cards, isn't it? What I got.
What should it be, do you think?
Well, what I was given for Christmas.
Should we say that, then, what I was given?
Would you want to change it to given or do you like God?
What I was given.
Yeah. So given, can I just check? So what I was given is now on the card. Those are the words we can say.
You know the words. You write them down, just Charles, because I know my memory's not as good as that.
He's an axe, he's learned.
I can learn a small part like that.
We are Radio 4, so I think we should stick to more grammatical words and phrases. What I was given for Christmas, Paul, starting now.
What I got for Christmas was a Super 8 projector which shows a particular kind of film, a narrow sort of celluloid, but you can get all kinds of movies from the past in this particular medium. Laurel and Hardy, Charlie Chaplin, Buster Keaton, Cary Grant, these are just some of the individuals who are captured on this particular form of entertainment. And with your own... Oh.
Charles Challenson.
I think he has a tail.
Yes, he did, and indeed, Charles, you have a correct challenge, you have a point, and you have how many seconds? 38. What I was given for Christmas, starting now.
What I was given for Christmas was the biggest stocking you've ever seen. My children and lovely wife had filled it with goodies beyond compare. Sweeties.
Graham Challenge.
Well, surely we can compare them to something.
Sweeties, you can't compare sweeties to anything.
No.
He's got sweeties in his stocking, Nicholas.
If you knew, the hardship that I have in my life, it is beyond compare as far as I'm concerned, Graham. No, do you?
Graham, to be fair to Charles.
You didn't see a walnut till you were 30, did you? Didn't see a walnut till he was 30.
He was so excited by a big sock.
No, it is a phrase that we use colloquially, isn't it? Beyond compare. So, benefit of the doubt to Charles, keeps the subject. 26 seconds. What I was given for Christmas, Charles, starting now.
The present I undid took so long to unwrap that the glue on the paper was going all tacky. But eventually I licked it off so I could find this large box inside containing...
Paul Charles.
Deviation. When you unwrap a Christmas present, it's not necessary to lick the glue off. What's going on?
That's meat and drink to Charles.
Yes.
That was probably his Christmas lunch.
Charles, can you justify licking the glue off a package?
Of course I...
He gets to taste the horse.
Carry on, I will.
Is this some perversion of yours or something?
No.
it's not at all.
You should become a member of GLA.
No.
Gleam Liquors Anonymous.
I gave you the benefit of the doubt beyond compare. I'm going to give it to Paul on this occasion. What I was given for Christmas, Paul, and there are 11 seconds left starting now.
I was given a glue-licking kit, and it's fantastic. What you do is you get hold of some sticky stuff, put it on your tongue, and start licking away.
Chappie.
Licking.
Two lickings there.
For a minute, licking. I wondered if licking was and in lick. The thing.
No, a glue-licking present you had.
Did I?
Yes. I was glue licking.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. That's right.
Too many lickings there, Paul.
Really?
Yes.
So, Chappie, you've got 4 seconds, and you have what I have, what I was given for Christmas, starting now.
Oh.
Hesitation.
Were you given anything for Christmas, Chappie?
Do you know, we don't celebrate Christmas, so I didn't really know what to say.
Oh gosh, that's such an emotional response.
I'm completely joking. No, I got presents. Don't worry.
Oh right.
Jeez, actually, we're not backwards.
Alana, I've got to tell you, you did pause for 2 seconds.
Did I?
Yes. So I think, as you have played the game quite a few times now,
yes.
I will have to say, Paul, it was a correct challenge.
Okay.
And you have two seconds on what I was given for Christmas, starting now.
A magnificent pair of leather football boots endorsed!
So at the end of that round, Paul was speaking of the whistle and got that extra point. He's now in the lead, 1 ahead of Chappie and 3 ahead of Charles and 4 ahead of Graham. And Graham, it's with you to begin. And the subject now is the best advice my mum ever gave me. Tell us something about that if you can. Oh, you don't look very happy with it, but try. 60 seconds, starting now.
The best advice my mother ever gave me was don't go into that room. I listened to her quietly as I sat in a corner rocking and crying. I was a troubled child. My mother put on her coat.
Charles Chalmers.
You repeated mother twice.
I know, because it says it's my mum on the card.
Mum? That's not very Radio 4 grammatical, is it? We'll get letters, Nicholas.
No, but to be fair to Charles, I did actually read out the best advice my mum ever gave me.
And if only I'd been listening to you.
And you grammatically put it correct and said my mother. But you did say mother twice, so Charles, you have a correct challenge. 47 seconds. The best advice my mum ever gave me, starting now.
The best advice my mum ever gave me was to shave first thing in the morning and floss cleaning my teeth before breakfast, because then I could prepare myself for whatever the day had in future. And I had in future.
I just felt that wasn't quite correct English.
And it wasn't very good English, no, not as we understand it. I compare myself for whatever my day had in the future.
No.
It's not good English. 33 seconds, Chappie, with you. The best advice my mum ever gave me, starting now.
The best advice my mum ever gave me was Heech nigeran nabosh har kori khodet mikhai bokon. Asan fikr nakon ke ino nishistan inja qizobat mikonan. It's how she talks.
Paul, your challenge.
Repetition.
What?
Hop.
No. It was pure Iranian. I understood every word of it. And
did you?
Yes.
What did you say?
She said, my mum gave me some very good advice and to be careful of men, particularly if you're going out alone, and one or two other things like that.
She described that blazer in detail, didn't she?
So she cleverly kept going anyway, and we all enjoyed it, so she has the benefit of the doubt. She gets another point, and she keeps the subject. 24 seconds, the best advice my mum ever gave me, starting now.
The best advice my mum ever gave me was, Chappie, don't listen to me. I have no idea what I'm talking about. I've lived in cloud cuckoo land for years, and frankly, I don't know why I get up in the morning and...
Charles,
there was a hesitation there.
There was a hesitation,
there was
Charles,
many.
Right. 12 seconds. You take over the subject. The best advice my mum ever gave me, starting now.
The best advice my mother ever gave me was to be kind and thoughtful to people. Always give them the attention you feel...
Paul Challenge.
Hesitation.
I think there was a hesitation,
really,
Paul, yes.
Wasn't it?
And you got the subject. With 5 seconds ago, the best advice my mum ever gave me, Paul, starting now.
The best advice my mother gave me was, she said, that is the clutch... The brake accelerator.
Chappie Challenge.
Okay, that was genuinely a slip of the finger. I'm so sorry. I'm sorry, Paul. Please forgive me.
Don't apologise, my darling. All that happens is Paul gets another point because you had a little Freudian
slip. I thought if I apologised, the point wouldn't
Sorry.
You might get the point, you know. Because I don't know what's gone wrong with this clock, because I think Sarah forgot to stop it, because it says
it's
now...
It's 2009 already.
Did you have... Because it says, according to this stopwatch, you have minus 1 second.
Minus 1 second. Shall I talk backwards? Talk backwards.
So, they say you have half a second. The best advice my mum ever gave me, starting now.
Never wear those trousers!
So Paul was then speaking as the whistle went again. The extra point has increased his lead at the end of that round, ahead of Chappie, Charles and Graham in that order. And Charles, we're with you to begin. The subject is the joys of caravanning. Can you tell us something? You must look like a caravanning man to the audience. Starting now.
The joys of caravanning are midsummer, with the van on the back of the car pootling along a single-track road at 35 miles an hour. And by the time you've reached Cornwall, over 17,000 people hate you more than anything in the whole world. But in fact, my family have had a mobile home for a number of years, which is screwed into the ground, fully plumbed.
Paul Tallant.
It's not mobile, then, is it? Deviation. Got a mobile home that's screwed into the ground.
That is a contradiction.
If you were screwed into the ground, you wouldn't be mobile, would you be, Nicholas?
They are described as mobile homes. But they
can be moved. I think that's the reason
they can be moved. They have wheels.
And that's why they're called mobile homes, even though they are stationary.
Exactly.
So, Paul, the benefit of the doubt, I always try and redress the balance if I can on occasions. Charles keeps going with 38 seconds on the joys of caravanning, starting now.
The joys of caravanning are waking up in the morning in a field somewhere remote that Nicholas Parsons didn't know existed and finding the cows surrounding your van.
Paul Challenge.
I challenged before you said van, but you said the joy is waking up in the middle of a field, but you hadn't mentioned a caravan, so I thought you just woken up in the middle of the field. No caravan at all.
The joys of caravanning is waking up in the middle of a field. Because you're in the caravan. I mean,
how stupid
do you think these people are?
What, out of 10?
What? We enjoyed Paul's interruptions.
Did we?
He gets a bonus point. But you would interrupt.
Do I get one as well?
So you get a point. No, you get a point for incorrect challenge.
Yeah.
And you have 28 seconds to try and continue on the joys of caravanning, starting now.
The gas cylinder can be rather annoying when it's...
Graham challenge.
Then it's not one of the joys of caravanning, is it?
I think the audience's applause endorses the fact that you had a logical challenge there, and you have 25 seconds. You tell us something about the joys of caravanning, Graham, starting now.
I think one of the real joys of caravanning is how clever the inside is. Something could be a bottle opener, and suddenly you twist it, apply a foot pump, and it's a walk-in shower. The table becomes a bed. The curtains are cheese graters. It's all so brainy. The joys of caravanning are immense, I think. You know, you all pack in there, and suddenly...
So Graham Norton was speaking then. He was also gained that extra point. And a huge round of applause from the audience. He's still in fourth place, but he... Give him time. He needs to gather his momentum. I mention those figures because we're into the final round.
Can I still win?
Anybody can win. You never know what's going to happen in this game.
But it'll probably be one of the four people sitting up here.
Yeah. That's a very, very shrewd observation, Paul. Chappie, the subject is clubbing. There are 60 seconds, as usual, starting now.
One of the wonderful things about getting older is I'm freely able to admit that I hate clubbing. I remember going clubbing when I was younger because I felt like I had to, and meeting men with names like Roberto from Bolivia. If you are from Bolivia, I can't do accents, Bolivia.
Graham Challenge.
Yes, repetition of the Bolivia.
That's right, yes. Well, listen, Graham.
Thank you.
You have clubbing. I don't know whether you've done it, but you can talk on the subject if you can. 48 seconds, starting now.
Any Saturday you like, Soho in the centre of London will be full of young kids going clubbing. And I can't help...
Paul Challenge.
I choose a Saturday in 1787.
And I think you'll find it's full
Any
of young
Saturday
people
you like.
Going clubbing.
I don't think in 1787 Soho was full of people going clubbing. Any Saturday
I
you like.
I say it was.
Nicholas, can you remember? Was Soho full? In 1787.
Of course I can remember. Why do you think they've got me for this job? But all I can say is that I'm sure the variation of clubbing, which wasn't used then, was probably happening. There were people going out to clubs if they did exist.
In 1787?
In 1787,
people
yes.
were going to clubs in 1787.
They wouldn't have called them clubs.
You heard him, Paul.
They'd
yes.
have called them clubs.
You asked him. He told you. Yes.
They'd have called them taverns.
Yeah, because you tell him.
They're going out to taverns.
Yeah,
and
see?
Other
yeah. Yeah.
Graham's got the subject. 40 seconds. Continue on clubbing, Graham, starting now.
Clubbing is very popular in Manchester. And I do wonder how many baby seals are in that city. I just don't know. And yet out they go, willy-nilly, each weekend. You can hear the howls of pain. But on a Monday, ooh, what warm, cosy jumpers and things they have.
Shabby challenge.
I was really enjoying what he was saying, but he kind of stammered.
Yes, I did.
Yes.
All right. So, Shappy, you want it back and you've got it. 24 seconds. Clubbing, starting now.
Roberto. Oh, what have I done now? Why did I even get out of bed?
Yes, well, because she repeated Roberto and she hesitated immediately.
I know so many other names.
I know. That's what happened in just a minute. Your mind gets fixed. 22 seconds. On clubbing, Paul, with you, starting now.
Samuel Johnson and Boswell would like nothing better than 1787 than to go clubbing in London. They would walk into taverns because in those days, those particular establishments were the closest you would get to a club, and people would gather, drink coffee, drink port, and would... Oh.
Charles.
Two drinks.
Right, and 9 seconds. On clubbing with you, Charles, starting now.
As an older man, when I stand on the street late at night and notice these young flippity-gibbets coming out of the clubs, I can't believe...
Graham challenged.
I'm just saving him from himself.
I must say...
I'm not sure it's a story you want to tell on the radio, Charles.
I must say, Charles, the image you give of you standing on the street. What has your wife got to say about all this?
What?
What's your wife got to say about you standing on the street looking at all these young birds?
My wife's not with me when I'm standing on the street.
Just stop, stop!
It gets worse, yes, it gets worse. So who
he's trying to take his wife out, is he, while he's ogling young girls coming out of clubs?
Of course not, but we just wanted a bit more professional. Graham, you challenge. What was the challenge?
Deviation from sense.
All right. Graham, you have...
What? Graham, stop him!
What kind of sense?
You can't... What?
It seemed extraordinarily devious what you were doing, Charles.
He's only having a look.
He might be a taxi driver.
He's 66, Nicholas.
Right. Charles Collingwood
is so... Maybe it's something Charles really feels he needs to share with the nation.
Charles Collingwood is so overcome with emotion and so distressed... that his particular fetish of going out to the street, ogling young women, which he has now confessed.
I'm in the Archers, you know. Oh, no, you're not.
Ruined his image with all the fans of the Archers. Yeah. But we're going to give him an incredible benefit of the doubt and say you've got half a second on more distressing information about clubbing starting now.
The hours I've waited...
So, Charles Collingwood was then speaking metaphorically when the whistle went and also brought the show to a close in classic style. Let me give you the final situation. Graham Norton, who's triumphed so well in the past, finished up in a brilliant, no, let me tell you, it was only just, but a brilliant fourth place. And just ahead of him was Shappy or Sandy, who's done so well, and ahead of her was Charles Collingwood, who did extremely well, but only 2 points ahead of Charles was Paul Merton. So we say, Paul, you are the winner this week. This edition of Just a Minute, and we'll want to tune in again at the same time next week. It only remains for me to say thank you to these four fine players of the game, Paul Merton, Graham Norton, Shappy Cassandy, and Charles Collingwood. I thank Sarah Sharp, who's helped me with the score, blown her whistle with great style. We thank our producer, Claire Jones. We're indebted to Ian Messiter, who created this amazing game. And we're grateful to this lovely audience here in the Radio Theatre, who've cheered us on our way magnificently. From our audience, from me, Nicholas Parsons, and the team, goodbye, thank you, and to our listeners, tune in again the next time we play Just a Minute. Yes.
Parsons. Nicholas Parsons is back at the same time next week when he's joined by Paul Merton, Clement Freud, Helen Lederer and Julian Clary.
Welcome to Just a Minute. Is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, once more it's my huge pleasure to welcome our many listeners, not only in this country, but around the world, but also to welcome to the programme four exciting, really dynamic players of this game, and they are seated on my right, Paul Merton and Stephen Mangan, and seated on my left, Pam Ayres and Giles Brandreth. And as usual, I'm going to ask them to display their knowledge and talent with words and language as they try and speak on a subject that I give them, and they try and do that without hesitation, repetition or deviation. Beside me sits Trudy Stevens, who's going to help with the score and blow a whistle when the 60 seconds have elapsed. We're in a Christmas mood, and the subjects have a Christmas flavour to them, and we've got Giles Brandreth to start us off. Oh, yes, a real Christmas subject. Building a snowman. Giles, tell us something about building a snowman in just a minute, if you can, starting now.
Let me take you back to the cold winter of 1955, when the snow lay deep and crisp and even, and Uncle Hubert took me out into the garden to build my first snowman. And it was indeed a snowman, not a snow person. I know that because of where he placed the carrot and the two sprouts. This was some years before he was arrested, but I was very pleased to be taken by him into that...
Pam, you've challenged.
I thought there was hesitation there.
There was no hesitation, but very devious thoughts.
Well, I thought there was a hesitation before by him, and I also think it's an exceedingly unsavoury image.
You don't know where it's going. You don't know where it's going.
The carrot and the...
Giles, it's already gone there. I'm going to give Pam the benefit of the doubt.
I don't like the sound of that Uncle Hubert at all.
I'd like to hear from Pam on the subject of building a snowman, and there are 34 seconds still available, Pam, starting now.
One of the truly happiest memories I have of snowy days is being out with my two sons and making a little snowball, which we rolled along until it got increasingly big, and then we could not move it any further. So we turned it into a man, and it was enormous, and we poised it on the top of a quarry, and it stayed there for ages. And that's all I've got to say.
Yes, Charles.
Hesitation.
Yes, indeed. So you got the subject back. Fair
play. It was savoury. I mean, it was a nice image, not like Uncle Hubert and his carrot and his sprouts.
Yes, stay off Uncle Hubert now if you can. 8 seconds, Giles, for you.
How many seconds?
Oh, no.
Only 8 seconds.
Oh, good.
Building a snowman, starting now.
What you have to do is pack the ice firmly and then get studs of coal to make glorious
buttons. Oh, Pam challenged.
Very suggestive.
This is putting people in a Christmas mood at home.
Yeah, there's a real Christmas spirit here, isn't there? Giles, it was an incorrect challenge,
flaky.
So you've got 3 seconds still on building a snowman, starting now.
Building a snowman is a metaphor for life because eventually, of course, it melts.
In this game, whoever is speaking when the whistle goes gains an extra point. It was Giles Brandreth, of course, and he's 1 point ahead of Pam Ayres, who's in second place. Stephen Mangan and Paul Merton have yet to score, but they're going to hear from them shortly. Pam, we'd like you to begin the next round. It's Brussels sprouts. Christmassy, right. You tell us something about Brussels sprouts in this game, starting now.
Some people like to perfume their homes using candles scented with jasmine, rose, geranium, chives and cloves, etc. But I prefer Brussels sprouts boiled for at least 45 minutes until they form a malodorous yellow mush stuck to the bottom of the saucepan. This is guaranteed to imbue your environment with the stench of the workhouse, boarding schools and old folks' homes of the nastier type. I can't think of anything.
Giles, your challenge?
Only because there was a hesitation.
I was. The whole show is on the story. On the left-hand side of the thing at the moment. Right. But you're correct, challenge, Giles. You have another point. 26 seconds are still available. Tell us something about Brussels sprouts, starting now.
I have a Christmas tree studded with Brussels sprouts that are diamond-encrusted, given to me by Damien Hirst last Noel. A very generous present that goes alongside the...
Yeah, right. Stephen, you've challenged.
Have I?
Yes.
I have.
Excellent challenge.
I have. I challenge.
Excellent challenge.
Yeah, excellent challenge. What is it, Stephen?
Did it begin with an H or an
no,
R
deviation.
Or a D? Yeah, deviation. Definitely yes. Deviation. I can't believe, Giles, yes. You deviated so much.
Oh, dreadful.
It was so glaringly
oh,
obvious
yes.
That you deviated.
No.
What are you talking about?
Yeah.
I believe it's my go. Right, yeah, let's move on.
So you have a point for a correct challenge.
Good.
And you have
cheers. Quite right.
11 seconds on... Brussels sprouts, starting now.
Brussels sprouts are evil, tasteless, ugly vegetables. I'd rather smash my teeth in with a spanner than eat them, unless they're cooked with onions and bacon, in which case they're delicious.
So Stephen Mangan was in, speaking as the whistle went. Gained an extra point. He's equal with Pam Ayres in second place, behind Giles Brandreth. And actually, Stephen, we'd like you to begin the next round. Choosing Christmas presents. 60 seconds, starting now.
Choosing Christmas presents is an incredibly important task because you can express how you feel about your loved ones through the medium of merchandise. I celebrate you, Aunt Agatha. I honour your wit, your wisdom, your quiet alcoholism and your violent flatulence with these lavender-flavoured soaps. Why did the wise men start this whole thing off? Seriously, they've condemned the rest of us to trudging around department stores on Christmas Eve like zombies, looking for presents for un... Oh. Oh.
Giles, your challenge first.
Hesitation?
Yes, 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 right. Yes. They let you get away with five yours then. And... 26 seconds for you, Giles, on choosing Christmas presents, starting now.
On the whole, when it comes to choosing Christmas presents, I prefer to give people what they need rather than what they want. So in the case of Great Aunt Agatha...
Poor challenge.
A repetition of what they.
What they, yes.
Mm-hmm. Fair enough. Oh, yes. Good to see you. This Christmas spirit is everywhere.
Oh, yes.
As soon as you've introduced Uncle Hubert to our world, I don't think
so. Paul, 17 seconds are still available. You tell us something about choosing Christmas presents, starting now.
Well, of course, this is the reason why this subject has come up, because this time of year, we've all been doing it lately, haven't we? Walking through the high streets, bustling away in this... What a terrible winter it's been! Who would have thought, since the beginning of October, it just snowed incessantly for 3 months right to the end of the year?
There was a slight hiatus there because someone pressed a buzzer as Trudy put the whistle in her mouth. She didn't know whether to blow it or not, and I told her to blow it, and she thought I meant something else.
As I say, Christmas time is a time when...
And poor Trudy now is in hysterics. And Paul, you were speaking at that moment, so you've got 2 points, and Stephen's got 2 points, Pam's got 2 points, Giles is in the lead with a few more, and... Well, who's going to treat next? Paul, it's your turn to begin. Oh, Christmas crackers. Oh, tell us something about those in this game starting now.
Well, I think with the enthusiasm with which our chairman introduces this subject, it's often matched by those of us who are pulling these Christmas crackers apart during the festive season. But how disappointed we are when we read the third-rate, poor-quality jokes within. Why can't they just have wonderful sayings of wisdom? For example, was it not Confucius who once said, "That's enough trifle for me"? I'd like to know about that. And how did the Chinese celebrate Christmas thousands of centuries before Jesus was born? That's the sort of...
Pam, challenge.
I think thousands of centuries is a bit of a long time. I think
that's
perhaps,
right.
Perhaps that was a bit of an exaggeration.
Pam, you have a point. You have the subject. You have 31 seconds. Christmas crackers starting now.
I was working in Australia and I saw in a shop a very nice ring. And as the tour had gone exceedingly well, I decided to buy myself a treat in the form of the said item of jewellery. Showing it to my husband, however, he said, "Oh, it looks like something out of a Christmas cracker." And this immediately conjured up images of tawdry, worthless, plastic, brittle and horrible goods. And I did not buy it. And that is all I have to say.
Oh, Pam, saved by the whistle. And you were speaking then as Whistle Wayne gained that extra point, and you move forward. You're 1 point behind Alida Giles Brandreth, and you're a couple of points ahead of Stephen Mangan and Paul Merton. And Giles, it's your turn to begin. A round robin is the subject. There's 60 seconds as usual, starting now.
Now that the children have left home and it's just the two of us, we have eschewed the plump turkey for Christmas and are going for a round robin. With a wonderful nut roast. It's a beautiful, plump, fat creature. We...
Pam challenge.
I'm a member of the RSPB.
Yeah, yeah.
I cannot listen to this any further.
But it was Uncle Hubert's favourite.
Pam, you have the benefit of the doubt.
Thank you very much.
Yes.
Thank you.
And you have 43 seconds. Tell us something about a round robin, starting now.
In order to achieve a round robin, one must feed it enormous quantities of mealworms and fat balls.
It's Christmas. This is Christmas.
Yeah.
Honestly.
Well, Giles, what's your challenge?
Well, I'm a member of the Royal Society for the Protection of Earthworms. And here is this cruel woman stuffing this lovely, delicate robin. I was giving it a nut roast, lovely veggie fare. She's feeding other animals to
it. Yes, but you were feeding it from one orifice and I was feeding it from the other.
If you meet in the middle, you can make a wish.
Yeah. 35 seconds are still available, Pam. A round robin starting now.
By taking a handful of normal bird seed and pouring dripping or the roast...
Paul challenge.
A slight hesitation.
It was a big hesitation. Yes. No.
So there are 27 seconds still available, Paul. A round robin starting now.
It's one of these letters, I don't know if people still do them. Simon Hoggett writes a column in The Guardian every Christmas to suggest people do. Send these round robin letters around where you...
Stephen challenge.
Two letters.
Yes, absolutely, yes.
Yes, yes. Well, listen, Stephen. Stephen. A round robin starting now.
Round robin actually began in the 19th century. It was a form of writing novels. One author would write a chapter and someone else would write the next one and so forth until you had a whole book. Round robin. There we go. Good night.
Paul, you challenge.
Slight hesitation.
Yeah, you should have kept on, and there were another 6 seconds to
I
go.
I know, but I was looking into your eyes, Nicholas, and I got lost.
Paul, you got in first. 6 seconds, a round robin with you starting now.
As I looked at my friend Robin, I realised his diet had gone horrendously wrong. Where he had once been a svelte.
So Paul Merton was then speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point. He's moved forward. He's equal with Giles Brandreth in second place, just ahead of Stephen Mangan, but they're 1 point behind our leader, Pam Ayres. And Pam, it's your turn to begin. A real Christmas subject. My tips on how to avoid arguments. 60 seconds, if you want them, starting now.
My tips to avoid arguments are to cultivate a list of platitudes which are absolutely meaningless but will placate a moron spouting drivel. For instance, amen to that is a good one. Or there's a man who knows what he's talking about. Letting you sit on the fence without coming down on either side of it. Thus, the moron feels attention.
Giles, your challenge.
Repetition of moron.
Yeah, we had the moron at the beginning, unfortunately, Pam.
Yeah, two morons.
28 seconds are still available, Giles. My tips on how to avoid arguments starting now.
Sitting next to Nicholas is a beautiful young person called Trudy who carries a whistle. And the way that we, when we're together, manage to avoid arguments is that I invite her to blow it when anybody is getting a bit fractious. Alternatively, the best way to avoid arguments is to doze off, to close your eyes and give the impression that you are snoozing and let the fight go on all around you and the traumatised family with aunts and uncles.
So, Giles Randolph was again speaking as a whistle when gained that extra point, and he's moved forward. He's one ahead of Pamez. He's two ahead of Paul Merton and three or four ahead of Stephen Mangan. And Stephen Mangan, it's your turn to begin. Ooh, what's the subject for you? He'll probably send me up. The subject is St. Nicholas. 60 seconds, starting now.
Some say that the character of St. Nicholas is a myth. Others that he is a mythter. But the story goes that Nicholas is an older gentleman. Nicholas watches over us all. Nicholas rewards us when we've been good and punishes us when we've been bad. And
Pam, challenge.
Weave. A repetition of weave.
I was enjoying the way it was going, actually. But it was a correct challenge, Pam. So you have St. Nicholas and you have 44 seconds starting now.
St. Nicholas is the patron saint of thieves. And I like to imagine thieves on bend...
Stephen, challenge.
Two thieves.
You've got it straight back.
Yes.
Another point, Stephen. 38 seconds still available, Stephen. St. Nicholas starting now.
As I was saying, Nicholas...
Poor challenge.
There must be repetition then. As I was saying.
It was a repetitious thought, Paul.
Wasn't it just?
Yes, but
yes.
He didn't...
I can see where this is going,
he didn't actually repeat words he'd said before.
Right. No.
So those are the rules of the game,
they
which
are.
You should know after all these years.
Yeah.
But we enjoyed the interruption.
Thank
Give
you.
Him a bonus point. And Stephen, you get a point because you were interrupted.
Thank you.
And you have 36 seconds starting now.
Without wishing to repeat myself, I was talking about Nicholas and his benevolent ways, watching what we were up to. And Nicholas has been doing this since the 4th century AD. He's famous for leaving coins in people's shoes, behaviour which nowadays would rightly get you arrested as some sort of weird fetishistic deviant. His most famous story involves a poor man who had three daughters. The man was unable to provide a dowry for his children and was worried that they would be unable to get married.
Giles, challenge.
Repetition of unable.
Yes. I know. Not... They want Stephen to go on. 8 seconds, Giles, with you. St. Nicholas starting now.
St. Nicholas gives us Santa Claus through Sinterklaas being a Dutch variation of the phrase. His feast day is the 6th of December when the true season of Christmas begins and carries on.
So Giles Randall, who's speaking of the whistle, Wayne, gained an extra point and he has increased his lead at the end of the round. And Paul Merton, we're with you to begin now and the subject is my favourite festive film. Starting now.
My favourite festive film, it wouldn't be It's a Wonderful Life. I hadn't seen that movie until I recently watched it, and because the reputation preceded it by so many decades, I didn't enjoy it perhaps as much as I should. Sometimes when you see a film, it's what you bring to it that helps shape your perception of it. My favourite festival movie, without any doubt, is the Laurel and Hardy short Big Business, where they are selling Christmas trees door to door in California.
Yes.
Wonderful. Door to door, yeah.
Two doors.
Yeah, I forgot I was playing just a minute for a moment.
Mm. You were away, your thoughts were in the film.
Yes, they
but,
were.
But Stephen picked you up on that, and he's got 38 seconds to tell us something about my favourite festive film starting now.
My favourite festive film is The Exorcist, because nothing brings to mind the tension, the violence, and the brutal murder that I associate with Christmas like that movie. My Auntie Agatha used to shoot her tongue across the room, wrap it round my neck, and fling me against the wall. And my sister could revolve her head 360 degrees.
Giles, challenge.
Repetition of head.
Yes. Giles, 16 seconds available. My favourite festive film starting now.
The chalice from the palace has the pellet with the poison, but the brew that is true is in the flagon with the dragon comes from Danny Kaye's wonderful film, The Court Jester, which is always my favourite festive film. With my children and we grandchildren, a hyphenated phrase, I really enjoy celebrating...
Sir Giles Randall was again speaker. The whistle went, has increased his lead at the end of the round. The other three are almost equal in second place, a few points behind him. And Giles, it's actually your turn to begin. And the subject now, oh, a real Christmas subject, how to fill a stocking. 60 seconds.
Should we buzz now?
Trying to keep it Christmassy if you can, Giles.
I'm not sure that's a good idea.
How to fill a stocking, Giles? 60 seconds starting now.
Because litigation is still pending with Scarlett Johansson's fiancé, I will indeed keep it very Christmassy, and I will start with the stocking and a tangerine.
Pam, challenge.
I will. You said I will twice.
I did.
So, Pam, you got in with 52 seconds to go still. How to fill a stocking, starting now.
The choice of stocking is crucial. I recommend a lisle one in a shade called Tea Rose, which should be rolled carefully over the bunions, over the ankles, past the varicose veins.
Repetition of over.
Yeah. Over. Oh. Yes. 37 seconds, Paul. How to fill a stocking, starting now.
Well, in the old days, because a stocking was only a small thing, it would be an orange, perhaps a wooden toy, perhaps a photograph of your real father.
Oh, Stephen Challenge.
Two perhaps.
Yes, more than one perhaps. So, Stephen, you've got the subject as well. We're going to hear from everybody on it. 30 seconds, how to fill a stocking, starting now.
My favourite way to fill a stocking is to get an East End thug and put it over their head and they can walk up to a man and say, "Give me your money!" What was wrong with that?
It was a repetition of That's
how they talk. I must say, Stephen, you do bring a sense of anarchy to this programme. Right, Paul, correct challenge. Hesitation. 21 seconds. How to fill a stocking, starting now.
When I think back to the first woman I fell in love with, I can see her face now. I can almost...
Stephen, challenge.
Two I cans.
Yes,
yeah, two I cans. So, less anarchy, we hope, Stephen, but... How to fill a stock. It is Christmas time, remember.
Absolutely.
15 seconds starting now.
Start the getaway car, Trevor. We've got a Christmas meal to eat. I've got eggnog cooking on the stove, and I can't wait.
Giles Challenge.
Repetition of Christmas, because is it the phrase a Christmas stocking or just a stocking?
No, it's how to fill a stocking, actually, yeah. Quite right.
Oh.
And you repeated Christmas.
Oh. But he was
put off, because I... talked about a Christmas stocking when I gave you something.
I know we were all put off by listening.
I think
to
I was.
but we carry on in the spirit of Christmas.
It is how to fill a stocking, Stephen. Benefit of the doubt to Stephen. He keeps going. Mm. Giles, I'm asking you in strong lead. I'm asking you to show a little bit of course, Christmas spirit.
Of course, the Christmas spirit. Absolutely.
Christmas spirit, right?
Absolute Christmas spirit. Yes. Carry on, Stephen. He's brought the exorcist into it. Muggers, murder. But fine, of course, the spirit of Christmas is redolent in Stephen Mangan.
And there speaks the man who brought us Uncle Hubert.
7 seconds for you, Stephen, on how to fill a stocking, starting now.
Perhaps the most famous stocking film...
Hesitation.
Yes, because he thought it was a rather festive film. He got the subjects muddled, didn't he? Mm. Filling a stocking, my favourite festive film. It's impossible. Stephen's got his head in his hands at the moment, listeners, and but Pam's got the subject, and she's got 4 seconds on how to fill a stocking, Pam, starting now.
Finally, popping the top of the stocking into a great knobbly suspender, which is...
So, Pam, who then speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point, and we are moving into the final round.
Oh, dear.
Oh, what a lovely audience you are. They're very close. There's a spirit of Christmas exists between them. Oh, only 1 point separates them all. In descending order, Giles, Pam, Stephen and Paul. 1 point separating them in descending order. Oh, we've got a wonderful Christmas subject to finish on. Pam, it's your turn to begin too. Pantomimes. Tell us something about pantomimes in this game. 60 seconds starting now.
Having no wish to sound a discordant note, I must say that I detested pantomimes in the 70s when tired...
A poor challenge.
Oh, no, you didn't.
Right, but no challenge when the rules are just a minute.
No.
Right. an incorrect challenge, Pam. You've still got 53 seconds. Pantomime's starting now.
When tired old pop stars came out and sang boring old songs.
Yes, just.
Repetition of old.
Yes, it was too much old there. And the 47 seconds still available. Giles, tell us something about pantomimes starting now.
I once appeared in a politically correct pantomime entitled Snow Green and the Seven Persons of Restricted Growth. Success, though my essaying the part of Baron Hardup was confusing because this is a character that customarily appears in Cinderella, which I have also done. The pantomime dates back to the Greek and Roman theatre, but was turned into the entertainment we know through the Commedia dell'arte companies coming to this country.
Pam Chanish.
I think it's all very pretentious, myself.
Well, you've got to allow him to speak. That's his raison d'etre, isn't it?
Yeah, that's right, yeah. I don't know what you're talking about.
Neither actually, do I.
Pam, I gave him a number of bonus points. I gave one to Paul just then. You get one for that because we enjoyed it. But Giles was interrupted, so he keeps the subject. And there are 21 seconds pantomimes with you, Giles, starting now.
I'm a particular admirer of the Victorian pantomime when people like Dan Leno and Mary Lloyd played the chief roles. In shows called Sinbad the Sailor, always a favourite in yesteryear, but now considered the unlucky panto.
Paul Charles.
Well, I suppose it's very pedantic and it is Christmas time, but not all the shows were called Sinbad the Sailor.
No.
I mean, not all the pantomimes in Victoria, but you know where I'm going.
No, it was a bit pedantic, but a correct challenge.
Yeah, it's a correct challenge.
So you get a point.
Yeah.
Paul, 7 seconds with you on pantomimes starting now.
I remember seeing Cliff Richard and the Shadows with Arthur Askey appearing at the London Palladium, and they were there, even though the Beatles were top 5 records in America.
Well, at the beginning of that round, I said 1 point separated them all in descending order, and it's exactly the same at the end of that round. In fourth place, but a very fine fourth place, was Stephen Mangum. Oh, the spirit of Christmas still exists in this audience, yeah. And 1 point ahead was Paul Merton. And 1 point ahead was Pam Ayres. And 1 point ahead, and our winner, Giles Brandreth. Well, we do hope you've enjoyed this edition of our Christmas show of Just a Minute. It only remains for me to say thank you to these four fine players of the game. We're grateful to Trudy Stevens, who's helped me with the score. She's blown that whistle so delicately all through the year. We're grateful to our producer, Katie Tyrrell. We're indebted to Ian Messiter, who created this amazing game. And we're indebted to this lovely Christmas audience. And so, from me, Nicholas Parsons, and from our audience and our listeners, don't forget, tune in the next time we play Just a Minute! Yeah.